One. Yo, what is going down, y'all? Welcome in the most underrated podcast you already know.
Hell yeah!
Broadcasting from Most Underrated Studios, I am your man, Thomas the Franchise, the homie Dal Palantonio, chilling across from me.
Yo!
Levels good, y'all. No echoes, nothing, everything's good.
No, everything's good.
Yes, all right. Hell yeah. I think it's the first time we might have started off. We're hella late. But it's the first time we might have started off without any technical difficulties in a minute since we started using a lot more functionality, a lot more technology around here.
True that.
Shout out to everybody in the chat, man. Thank you guys for being in the chat. If you've already clicked the like button on the show, I deeply appreciate you guys for that. A lot of shit talking in the chat, and I mean that in a literal sense. A lot of talking about us taking shits in the chat and being so late. So sorry about that, guys. Sorry that we are late. Obviously, a little bit of a crazy circumstance. We decided to do the show late just so we could watch the rest of the Kobe Bryant Memorial, as well as let you guys watch that and not have to make you jump back and forth or whatever.
Sure. That's some respect there.
Yeah. So let's just start there, fellas. What did you think of the memorial?
I guess I'll start off. Still trying to get the words for it, but I feel really bad for saying that, because how does Vanessa get the words? How is she able to get up there, and the strength that she has, and being able to just articulate things in the way she did, and talking about losing, what is it, her second youngest, I think? Because they had the new baby, I think just a few months back. Mm-hmm. Gotta tell you, man, that took some strength for her to have to do that. The articulation was great. Her stories were great. She talked a lot about Gianna's kisses and just the type of gal, young gal that she was, and the woman that she was striving to be, and how she was probably going to change basketball. So that was enlightening to me. It was precious. And I got a lot from Vanessa, and just I have a whole yet another respect for her.
Yeah, just talking about, like you said, Gigi was a daddy's girl, but she loved mommy a lot, and a lot of that stuff really touched me. And then when so many different celebrities and just people that Kobe had touched went up there and gave speeches, and I wonder who had the job of choosing that list.
Yeah, no doubt.
How do you choose?
I'm sure Vanessa,
right?
Yeah, they made the call. But
yeah, how do you choose? How do you choose who to ask to go up there? Who to leave off? Who said no? Who maybe that they did ask? I'm curious about that.
Were you surprised to not see Phil?
Yes and no.
Yeah.
Yes and no. There's a lot of people that could have been chosen. I'm really not surprised or surprised we didn't see or did see anyone. I think that it would have just been way too hard. It was one of those situations. As I watched the people going up, that's when I kind of got surprised. Mm-hmm. Like seeing Diana Taurasi go up there, the White Mamba, she calls herself.
Totally.
You know?
Yeah.
That was great, dude. Her talking about Gigi, her talking about her relationship with Gigi and how Gigi wanted to go play at UConn. That really got to me, man. That really got me. What was Shaq was a little short. I thought Shaq would be a little longer, but I think they had already been sitting there a long time. How in the hell do you follow up Michael Jordan? How?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? What do you do there? Michael, that was my favorite part.
Yeah.
That was my absolute favorite part. No disrespect to anyone else that spoke, but I do have some sound from Michael Jordan that I'll play here in a second. But I just really enjoyed what he did up there. And as far as Shaq going after, I thought it was almost perfect. I didn't think Shaq would go short, and I thought what he did was perfect because he said his piece, man. He did his whole thing on NBA on TNT. Mm-hmm. You know, he gushed. He was leaking all over that thing. He didn't want to go up there and do that again.
Right.
And I think he knew he didn't really need to do that. Mm-hmm. He didn't need to say what's already been said, what's already been done. So I thought that was great by Shaq. I thought the whole thing was great. I thought Jimmy Kimmel did a nice job navigating the entire thing.
Yeah.
That was good.
That takes a lot. Yeah, you could definitely hear it in his voice as he was kind of transitioning from speaker to speaker and then remembering in between those speakers himself. That's a strong ask and a big job. It sounded like John King said Vanessa asked each one of the speakers
to
speak. Yeah.
Always dropping knowledge in the John chat, King. Man. Thank you guys, all of you guys that always put us up on shit while we're doing the show. I love that. I don't have all the answers, man. I'm just the guy sitting here in front of the mic. I realistically, I'm a moron 90% of the time. Jalal, what did you think of the memorial, and what was your favorite part?
Like you said, man, my favorite part was the Jordan.
Jordan.
I didn't actually expect Jordan to even go up there.
Right?
Jordan's not the guy that people kind of think of for going out and talking in front of everybody.
He stays out of the limelight specifically because he's gone on to say many times, like, I was in the limelight for a long time. I don't need to be in that anymore.
I take that back. I said I wasn't surprised. I was very surprised by Michael Jordan.
I was too.
And what he delivered. I was surprised. That was my favorite. I was surprised. Jordan's not a guy you get a ton of microphones in front of. When you do get a microphone in front of him, he oftentimes doesn't say flattering shit.
Mm-hmm.
He just doesn't say anything that makes you feel any really that great about him or that great about the people he's talking about.
Yeah.
That's just Michael Jordan, including, I mean, even his Hall of Fame speech. He's up there roasting fools. You know, mm-hmm. It's like, geez, you're going
to
the Hall
of Fame.
I'm sure
he got a lot of help with this one, just right. Making sure he said the right thing.
No, stop it. Yeah, this was from the heart, guy.
But of course it's from the heart, but I think you got to have help just making sure you don't, you know,
mess anything
veer
up.
Off too much.
Veer or, off. I thought he did a great job.
Yeah, he did a great. If anybody, though, I wanted to see more from Shaq, even though he did say his piece. I just would have liked to, you know, after having him process a little bit, maybe get some stories or something. But I understand why, you know, but that's the only thing.
I like the assurance that he offered, you know, Kobe's family. Mm-hmm. I got you. I'm here for you. You know, and I really believe
you're
that,
talking about
man.
Jordan?
Oh, yeah. No, Shaq.
Shaq.
Shaq is really, that was kind of his, was so short, right?
Yeah,
but
yeah.
He offered a lot of like, hey, I'm here for you. I got you. You know, don't worry about you guys.
Yeah.
I got you.
I think a lot of people, Jordan kind of said that in a way too. Like, hey.
Him and his
always,
wife.
Yeah, him and his wife, you need anything. Let me play some comments from Michael Jordan. This is him talking about what he learned from Kobe Bryant. He said that Kobe felt like he often was trying to take from him. This is him saying what he himself learned from Kobe. I thought this was very well said. Let me, what is it, 753? Yeah, very well said in the way he went through it all. So if you didn't catch it earlier, this is the clip from Jordan there at the memorial.
I went and saw Phil Jackson in 1999 or maybe 2000. I don't know when Phil was here in LA. And I walk in and Kobe's sitting there. And the first thing, I'm in a suit. First thing Kobe said, did you bring your shoes?
I'm in a suit, he said.
No, I wasn't thinking about playing. But his attitude to compete and play against someone he felt like he could enhance and improve his game with. To me, that's what I loved about the kid. Absolutely loved about the kid. No matter where he saw me, it was a challenge. And I admired him because his passion, you rarely see someone who's looking and trying to improve each and every day, not just in sports, but as a parent, as a husband. I am inspired by what he's done and what he shared with Vanessa and what he's shared with his kids. I have a daughter who's 30, I became a grandparent. And I have two twins. I have twins at 6. I can't wait to get home to become a girl dad and to hug them and to see the love that and the smiles that they bring to us as parents. He taught me that just by looking at this tonight, looking at how he responded and reacted with the people that he actually loved. These are the things that we will continue to learn from Kobe Bryant.
There you go.
Well said.
Dude, wasn't that such a great clip? I think just the way he talked about right there at the end, wanting to become a girl dad, even, you know, he has a daughter that's 30 now, he has twin granddaughters,
mm-hmm.
and just talking about wanting to be a girl dad, I think that in that moment, I thought, wow, how many people did Kobe Bryant change the life or the thought process for of guys that are dads to daughters
mm-hmm.
that maybe, it's not to say they weren't good dads, but they could be a little bit better. Mm-hmm. They could be a little bit more proud. They could be a little bit more representative. They could just do a little more for girls in general, their daughters in general. You know, when I think of Kobe Bryant, I think of one of my best friends, Vitzer. one of my best friends in the world. This is a guy that has two daughters the same way. And then last summer, I got to witness him out there coaching them in soccer, out there running around on the field, coaching them. And he's the first guy I thought of when I thought of Kobe and I thought of him passing. And we heard all this stuff coming out about girl, dad, and daughters, because Witzer's just been that way. You know, he's been that representative for his daughters and championing them, and they could do anything the boys can do, and he's really pushed them. And man, I'm just so proud of him as a friend. And bringing it back to Kobe, I think there are so many dads that, admitted or not, will use this to better their relationship with their daughters.
Sure.
What do you guys think about that?
Yeah, I think Kobe, what he was able to do was show the dads out there that continually had girls as kids, and almost assured them to let them know that it was okay. Hey, I know you've been trying for a boy. There's a lot of dads out there. There's a lot of parents out there that have been like, God, let's keep trying. We can get that boy. We can get that boy. And Kobe says, it's okay. Be proud. Be proud to be a girl's dad. If that's what it is, if that's what the Lord hands you.
Right.
Be grateful for that. And I think that's kind of a mindset as well. You know, you don't always have to just keep trying to get somewhere. You don't know what hand you're going to be dealt. So it's okay to be a girl's dad. You know what I mean? And I think that, you know, Kobe just made it cool. Like, Kobe made it okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. So much good conversation in the chat, man. I'm so glad you guys can go back and forth with each other. Socratic mind, this is interesting. I understand people react differently in a time of grieving. I found it interesting that MJ was more emotional than any of the people closely related to Kobe. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what that was. I don't know if that's Jordan up there. He just hasn't really spoken in a public forum. The other people have. It's been, you know, kind of like I was talking about with Shaq or whatever. Shaq didn't seem that emotional up there, but he's gotten it kind of, not to say you ever get it all out, but he did that. And I'm not, you know, I don't know. I don't know what the reason is. But the reason I picked that comment out is interesting. MJ was just leaking, bro.
Mm-hmm.
Leaking up there.
Yes, he was.
And you brought it up to me. You're like, oh, dude, the crying Jordan meme. I didn't even think of that. But that's the world we live in. That's the world we live in. That's Twitter. That's everyone else. But I thought that was some hilarious sound. If you missed that from the press conference, this is how that piece sounded.
Now he's got me. I'll have to look at another crime meme for the Knicks.
So good.
Everyone just instantly erupts. Dude, that's the biggest applause of the night. Yeah. Or the day right there.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
I think everybody needed some laughs.
Everyone needed that, dude. Oh,
perfect,
I love it.
Perfect timing.
Yeah.
I told my wife I wasn't going to do this because I didn't want to see that for the next 3 or 4 years. That is what Kobe Bryant does to me.
Oh, dude, right there, man.
I think a lot Michael of people Jordan. Just had a tricky relationship with Kobe, you know, like even though him and MJ were friends, it's like a little competition, maybe in the early days, like he was saying, there was some agitation and he's trying to get the moves and all that. So I think that might have something to do with why people are so emotional, and just, you know, even Shaq, his relationship with Kobe. It was love, but there were some tricky things within the relationship.
Michael Jordan said it a lot, you know, back in the earlier days. You know, he said he'd get text messages at 2-3 o'clock in, you know, in the morning about moves and what we can do and about these moves. And he said, man, I was agitated. And I was like, God, why am I answering all these things? And it became love, you know, as time
Kobe
went on.
Kobe was just different, man.
He said that multiple times throughout the, even when he was being a pain in the ass, I think he said it to the exact words, called him a pain in the ass. It was love, and that was the relationship. It's, man, just so interesting.
And I think the vibe was always like, if you would ask me or anybody else, I think if you would have been like, hey, do you think Kobe and Michael are pretty close? I think a lot of us would have said no, just because that competitor mentality, you know, that they both have. Like, Michael Jordan had the most intense competition mentality, I think, of all time, arguably in sports. Like, you could argue his, and I think that's what that will to win just willed him so far within his career. Sure, he had a lot of natural talent. There's no doubt about that. But that guy just couldn't fathom losing. He couldn't. And I think he was different.
Yeah.
And if you would ever ask me, like, you know, you think Kobe and Jordan get along? I'd be like, hell no, man. They're enemies, dog. They're the two most competitive people in the world. And there's no way I would have thought they would have ever gotten along, you know?
Well,
so it was cool to have that insight.
Well, especially with the stories you hear about MJ and him being like Mr. kind of away from the game. Well, actually, I guess on the court, off the court, he's the max competitor. Mm-hmm. He doesn't seem like he's a guy that's going to show anyone to move or go break some shit down to give you any competitive advantage. And he doesn't sound like a guy that's going to mentor anyone.
Yeah.
He doesn't sound like he wants to be big brother to anyone. This is fool that is snapping necks and cashing checks.
Yeah.
He's going out there. He's performing at the highest level. And he's doing the same thing off the court. Whether it's drinking, it's smoking cigars, it's
golfing.
Heavy gambling, it's heavy golfing. We're talking about a guy. I mean, you hear stories about Jordan, like, yo, shows up to Bulls practice. Phil, I got a 4 o'clock tee time.
Yeah.
Practice starts at 1:30, 2 o'clock. I'm going to be out of here. And Phil wasn't going to test him. Mm-hmm. Even if they needed to get more shit done. Yep, we're going to end it here early. Mike's got a 4 p.m. tee time. You know, you hear stories like that. And that's why I can't wait for that 30 for 30 to come out with the 6-part series with Jordan and the Bulls and all that shit.
That's June?
Yeah, June, this summer.
So excited.
When there's nothing going on. You know, the dead of baseball, all-star break, just dead. That's going to be a fire week in sports. But, just to wrap this up, man, I really loved we all needed that laugh. That was well said. We all needed the laugh with the crying Jordan stuff. Kobe and Gigi and the seven others in our prayers, man, in our thoughts, in our prayers. As we move forward, tons of show for you guys today. Thank you guys for coming in on a late edition of the Most Underrated Podcast. That's what's great about us doing our own thing. We can bump it like that. We can push it like that if we need to, and it kind of makes it better for the show.
Yeah.
So we have a tons of sneaker talk for you guys, including these. Dow brought in my, actually, I'm not going to take them off now. I'll take them off in a little bit. Mm-hmm. Dow brought in my UNC to Chicago's, which are actually the NC to Chicago's. You just put me up on game this morning. I didn't know they changed the name from UNC to Chicago to now just NC to Chicago. NC to you can tell me about that later. But I have a lace swap that I did on these. He brought me my pair. I'm wearing them on the show. I want to talk about the difference between UNC and Carolina Blues, the differences kind of between them, how they do it. I'll show you which laces I swapped it with, all of that stuff. We got the Yeezy Earth in studio.
Yeah.
Dal Palantonio hit on those. Who is even going to go for those? And now Dal looks like the smartest man.
Yeah.
He's got a pair of shoes the color of his flannel here, and he's coming up. Well, actually, I don't even know if they're the color of the flannel. I haven't looked at them in person yet.
They're different.
Any spoiler? No, okay, don't give me any spoilers.
No spoilers. No spoilers.
Don't give me any spoilers. So we're going to take a look at those as well. We got it on this day for you. If we have time to get to it, 42-year-old Zamboni driver made his NHL debut, and he was sitting in the crowd, and he came in and played on the ice and got a W for the Carolina Hurricanes. I'm going to tell you that whole story. Man, my man Dave Ayers, we're going to go over all of that. That shit is insane to me. Mm-hmm. But let's start here. Let's start out. Huge weekends.
You guys want to catch up on some of the
comments?
The paid ones?
Yes. Oh, shit. Thank you. Jalal, yes, keeping us on track.
Well, people are paying money? All right.
I love it. Thank you, bro. Thank you.
We got to make sure the people that are putting their dollars down are getting some love.
Thank you.
I guess we should start with Misha.
What has Misha got for us?
Yeah, the $4.99 to get the show going.
To get the show going. Misha, I'm sorry, bro.
I think that was when you guys were sword fighting.
Please.
Is that what? You can't cross streams.
Stupid.
All right, I'm feeling
there's
this
only,
one, man.
There's only one toilet here, so that's
you know what's crazy is, Jalal, so you told me I should wear it, so I'll kind of take this off for a second because I think this is going to restrict my shooting, but, you know, Dallas was coming in with the bro guns today.
Yeah, I was like, you should just do that.
And
I didn't have enough time to get the blur ready.
And then
for the side boob?
Yeah.
Whoa, side boob.
We got to keep that in, you know what I mean?
NSFW going.
So, yeah. So we had to throw the flannel on today. So I'm being a little restricted here, but I'm feeling, you know what I'm feeling? Kobe!
Oh,
we missed that one.
Wow.
Damn,
sorry about that, Dal.
I was just excited.
Take the L on the way out.
That was not good.
I know.
Sorry about that, Mish.
Yeah.
Thomas Cervantes next.
Cervantes?
Get your ish fixed, $2.99.
What does that mean? Like start on time?
I think he was talking about the equipment or.
Oh, was it messed up?
Nah,
yeah, be a little more specific.
What is it messed up in here?
Our equipment's good. It's just user error sometimes.
Kobe. Oh, man, just a little bit short.
Take that L on the way out.
That is definitely not like my sex life. Definitely not.
Sorry about that, fellas. Thank you for the donations in the super chat. Yeah, if you guys have a question, man, you want to make sure it gets answered, we will definitely get to it in the super chat. Thank you to everybody that donates there. A lot of people hit me up, too, that are like, yo, I don't want to send it in the super chat because I don't want YouTube making any more effing money. I hate those guys. If you want to send it to @OMG, it's TTF @MostUnderratedPodcast on Venmo, mm-hmm. PayPal, Most Underrated Podcast at Gmail.
On PayPal.
Yeah, that's what it is. Most Underrated Podcast at Gmail on PayPal.
Yeah, you have a Venmo.
OMG, it's TTF of Venmo.
You know? Yeah, we don't have a most underrated Venmo yet.
I'll get those and I'll go ahead and make sure that I get them going. Did you have some shit you were going to say in the chat?
Yeah, I think Kobe's taking away those shoes, man.
What do you mean?
After that performance today.
Hey, I need another shot.
He's taking those sneaks.
I need another shot. When somebody donates a little bit more, I'm gonna make another shot. I'm gonna make this right today. Don't worry about it. So this weekend.
Yes.
You gonna start? You want me to start?
Well, we come in here on Friday, right after the we do the show Thursday. Mm-hmm. We come in here Friday. Actually, you're not even in here. I'm in here and I'm dying. I show up and I'm feeling a little bit allergic mm-hmm. when I left my crib. So I show up at the studio. And dang, bro, Ben side nips. The dang bros might be taking on another meaning.
Oh,
might
wow.
be taking on a whole new meaning. We'll get to that in a little bit. We have, oh yeah, because we're gonna open the sneaker raffle as well. Mm-hmm. Yep. But anyway, I come in here and I'm dying, dude. My shit is leaking all over. I'm like, what is going on? I call my girl. I'm like, you feel okay? She's fine. I'm like, must be allergies. I don't know what's going on. So I go over to Target and I buy two boxes of Kleenex. With the Vicks, because I'm like, man, I need some serious, serious shit. I didn't know they make Kleenex with Vicks. Life-changing. Great stuff. Until you have bad allergies, because you start using all these Vicks, and then you start rubbing your eyes. Now you're rubbing Vicks from the Kleenexes in your eyes.
Oh, not good.
So I'm over here dying, bro. I got Vicks in my eyes. My allergies are killing me. You called me, and you're like, and I try to explain to you what's going on, and then you showed up, and you're like, oh, holy shit.
Yeah.
You like,
I'm trying to get shirts shipped out. Yeah, I'm messing with printers here.
You hear me sneezing after sneezing.
I never see anything like it.
Dude.
You filled up a whole trash can of tissue.
I used both boxes, 96 tissues per box, went through both boxes. Oh, this trash was filled with 96, what is that? 100 and
too many.
100. So,
is that a commercial?
There was a lot of tissues, bro. I used both the little boxes of tissues, filled my shit up. And look at me. I look like a 4-year-old. Thank God the cameras aren't zooming in, because I got like skin that has been busted loose.
Oh, yeah. I do see that.
All around my shit. I'm sorry, Dad. I look like a 4-year-old whose mom has not properly wiped his nose at the park.
Yeah.
Or she's just gotten sick of wiping it because it's running and she's just like, ah, whatever. And the kid's face is just. It looks terrible, bro. Yeah. But my shit is skin. My skin is busted up.
It's like half melted. Half melted off.
It's all exactly.
Looks like you've been hanging out with Fail Beast in Australia, and you got a fucking bad tan that just went
right,
really bad.
Right, yeah, sunburn, bro. So yeah. This shit is just peeling. It's like crusting off. So the past 2 days, I've been putting chapstick and like Blistix on it, and then Neosporin at night trying to heal it up, bro.
Yeah.
Like, so I put Neosporin on today. This morning after I got out of the shower, before I put Neosporin, dude, it was so gross looking.
Oof.
I was like, babe. I don't even know how I'm going to do the show today. Like, it was all my mustache. Like, it was gross, bro. So anyway.
You needed those lotion ones, the Puffs lotion.
Yeah.
I was for real. I thought I had
For real.
I thought I had coronavirus going on.
For real.
So then Saturday comes and I'm a little bit better. Sunday comes, I'm better. Today, I'm feeling fine other than this residual effects. So it must have been like a crazy allergy thing. But then you told me you got sick.
Wow.
So how you're telling me you got sick? How did you? I don't think you got sick from me. I don't think I was sick. I think mine was just allergies.
Mine was completely different than yours.
And you got sick on Saturday?
Yeah. So I've had a bit of a sore throat here and there. It's like there in the morning, you know. So because I'm an open mouth sleeper, right? I've got a deviated I've got a deviated septum.
I do too.
I've got issues up there, man. I've got some of the worst allergies. So I'm an open mouth sleeper. I'm super dry in the morning. It's not good. Okay. So what I think happened was I kind of had the sore throat brewing, right? And it's there, and then it goes away, and I'm fine. Now, Robin got me something for Valentine's Day. She got me one of those ray gun massagers. It's an off-brand. Have you seen those? That actually, like, deep tissue massage you?
Dude, you got one of those?
I got one.
The things that the Astros were using to bang on trash cans.
Yep.
You got one.
Robin got me one for Valentine's Day. Now, here's what I would say. So Saturday night, we're like, hey, babe, you know, let's give each other massages finally, right? So I was like, oh, hell yeah, man. I've been having, you know, backs and shoulder issues. I'm like... I almost stripped halfway naked. I'm like, I'm laying down on the couch ready to get this massage. So she breaks out this gun. And I think what happened, it's such a deep tissue massage. And as you know, when you go get a traditional massage, it really invokes a lot of toxins.
It gets these
toxins out of your body that have been laying dormant for so long. You're supposed to drink a lot of water, you know, to detoxify yourself, all this stuff. Well, she was doing this thing, dude, just beating the shit out of my back, dude. Just deep tissue in it like you wouldn't believe, and I absolutely loved every minute of it. So what I believe was that sore throat that was kind of there and not.
Okay.
I think there was a lot of toxins that were laying dormant, and that damn deep tissue massager brought them all out, and come Sunday morning, i.e. yesterday, because the massage was Saturday night, you know, around 10, 10:30, dude, I was sicker than a dog. I was absolutely
crazy.
Sick.
So you're saying if you didn't do the tissue massage, you wouldn't have gotten sick?
I still have the toxins laying within me.
This is,
and that's what I think.
This is some.
Is that conspiracy bullshit? I think that's what happened.
It sounds conspiracy theory, but it's medical, so I don't know.
It's science.
I don't know anything about medical.
Yeah, maybe you just didn't flush the toxins out fast enough.
Maybe I just didn't flush the toilet. I don't know.
What do you? So you wouldn't have been sick if she wouldn't. So you're blaming Robin in a roundabout way.
No,
you're doghousing yourself up in a roundabout way. If she's really listening to what you're really saying, you're blaming her for making you sick.
I'm blaming this damn gun. It's that good.
Well, who got you the gun?
Robin.
Right. So what are we talking about?
Yeah. Are you pregnant or not?
I'm just kidding. I'm just trying to get you in trouble.
That's fair.
So you get sick.
Oh, dude.
Miserable sick. And
some of the worst.
Yesterday you didn't move. You're chilling.
I'm on the couch. You're doing your all day. Yep. Literally, I got up like to take, I don't know, 4 or 5 leaks because I couldn't even keep enough fluids in me, dude. Thanks to Body Armor, dude. God damn, that stuff, that's clinch, man. It does a great job.
Is it clutch or is it clinch?
Oh, well, I think what I meant to say was it did a great job clinching my third.
Quenching?
But quenching, not clinching for the win.
I'm going, I was man, confused. That was a, man, Deion Sanders, the way you backpedaled. It was fire.
It was a lot of, you know.
He was doing some moves. Oh, shit. Moonwalking on the six. Moonwalking in his bitch. Moonwalk. What is it? Who says that?
Moonwalking on the six?
Yeah.
A$AP Rocky.
Moonwalking on the... is that Drake or is that Rick Ross?
Moonwalking on the six. I don't
moonwalking
know.
In the six. Moonwalking in the bit. Maybe it's just some new shit that I'm about to put on TikTok.
I think that's some TTF.
All right, cool.
Nice.
I'm about to get royalties. About to get real royalties. All right.
So Saturday. So now the good thing was, so Sunday, you know, I'm sick as a dog. I'm still sick today a little bit. Didn't want to come in here. You know, Fail Beast already said MUP Studios ground zero for the coronavirus.
What do you mean?
You were sick all day on Friday. Now Dallas is sick. We got ground zero here at the MUP Studios.
You weren't sick, but you just had a crazy, like you showed up at the time we normally were about to almost start the cast. Like, and we weren't even going to, we thought we were going to delay the cast maybe just a little bit, you know, we didn't know. So what happened with you? You're having a bad time. Are you sick too, Joel?
No, I'm not sick. It's just today was crazy. I don't know. I woke up with like 50 text messages and just a bunch of stuff going wrong. So I had to just put out fires all morning. Mm. I don't know. I think it's a Mercury retrograde or something. Everybody's just
has to be something.
Panic.
Something's fucked up. Let me tell you this story and then we'll get into the Wilder Fury fight from the weekend. Mm. Did you hear about, okay, first of all, yes, today something is fucked up. Because I woke up, I was having a great morning, and then a bunch of shit started going bad in the crib. And then the wind this morning. I had this ladder out on my patio. Mm-hmm. Dude, the wind was all crazy this morning. It blew over.
It was bad.
Cracked my dog in the face. Oh, Benny what? In the face. Cut his face right here, right between, like almost right between the eyes, dude.
No shit.
Yeah, like cracked him in the head.
How big of a ladder? 6-foot ladder?
So I'm like, what the...
Like traditional ladder? 6-foot? Or is it like a step ladder?
No, it's like a, I'm trying to think how to explain it. It's like a step ladder, but it's probably like as long as this table, bro. And it's like a step ladder that comes up and then it just blew over.
That's a heavy bitch.
Yeah, it's heavy as shit though. Like it was leaned up sideways. It's hard to explain. Anyway, cracked him in the face. Dude, did you hear about Alex's dog?
I did.
Oh my gosh. I texted him this morning.
Yesterday,
dude,
was rough for us, Robin and I. Yeah.
He has a 5-month-old puppy. One of our closest homies has a 5-month-old puppy.
French.
And I'm recently, yeah. I was never a dog guy. I wasn't really an animal guy. And now that I have a dog, I have this like weird softness in relationship for dogs. It's an interesting thing that happened. But with his dog, it was 5 months old. He gave it a little bone and it choked, he said. He's like, dude, I felt so guilty. I gave it the bone and it choked and died right in front of my kids and in front of me. And there was nothing I could do. There was nothing I could do to save it. And so you're just talking about bad shit going on and just like a weird cycle of bad shit. And I'm totally feeling it. And then we have the memorial today. That's not necessarily bad shit, but you know, with Kobe passing away and the 8 other folks in there, it is bad shit.
Yeah.
You know, and it just makes you think about it, bro. It just, It sucks, man. It really does. It really does suck.
I can't imagine losing a dog like that.
No,
dude.
Hell no.
And it was a little tiny Frenchie, man. Just cute as
Five months old, bro. God. 5 months old.
And they had said, like, hey, we'd given him bones before.
Yeah.
You know, all these things kind of come into play. It's like, was it a different bone? Was it something that they're not used to? Accidents happen, but God dang, in front of the kids. And yeah, oh, my God. I just can't imagine, dude.
Super, super shitty. So among the things that went on this this weekend, there was some UFC fights as well. We'll get to in a second, but let's hit Wilder Fury first. Obviously, that is the big bout of the weekend.
Yeah.
That's the big fight of the weekend. Did you buy it? Did you go somewhere to watch it? What'd you do? How'd you get down?
You know what, man? You know, since I am a part of the MUP cast, I had to finally try out Buff Streams. And I got to tell you, I give it an A+. I had a great experience.
Oh, you were on the streaming tip?
I had a great...
Oh, let's go.
I had no problems.
You guys too?
I had a great experience with Buff Streams this past
weekend.
I'm trying
to tell you guys, man. I've been trying to put people up on game. I've been trying to put people up on game.
It was so easy. They have, like, you go straight to the website.
Yep.
MMA, boxing, whatever.
Yep. You got to close a couple pop-ups maybe, yeah.
Or maybe two when you expand the screen.
Exactly.
You get two pop-ups and you're in there.
But other than that, dude, right? Great shit.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I was trying to put you guys up on, man. The last episode... You guys got to check out the Buff Streams, man.
Yeah.
If you're paying for the fights or whatever, if you ain't got money, if you're missing the fights, put you up on game. There you go. So the fight overall, I didn't pay too much attention to the undercard. Obviously, the big mm-hmm. the big fight. Tyson Fury comes out on the with the crown and on being carried out on the throne there.
Yeah.
What were your thoughts of him coming out? And then coming out to crazy... Crazy for feeling.
Yeah.
Did you see that? Patsy Cline. He's coming out just singing it along to the crowd. He's like this, you know, singing along. What'd you think there? Do you think it was he was making a statement like, I'm about to take this fool out? Or do you think it was like, oh shit, now this fool better win? Like, it, to me, that's what it looked like. I was like, oh,
yeah.
If this fool doesn't win now and he's coming out crowning himself and he's coming out on the throne and he comes out, even if he gets knocked out, it's really bad. But even if he just loses, it still looks bad.
For sure.
Still looks bad.
You know, anytime you want to come out like a Transformer, like AKA the Megatron group, to me, you better bring it during the fight. And I was a little weirded out. I just, even the previous fight with him and Fury, I don't know what the hell he was wearing, all gold and bejeweled like mask. I'm not really into it. I don't really like it at all. It's not for me. But him looking like a Transformer this go around, I said, this fool better bring it.
And a Transformer?
Yeah, like Megatron.
Yeah.
Like the bad guys of the Transformers. Yeah, that guy fool looking weird, man.
So overall, when the fight started, that was my kind of thing. When I went back and forth and I was watching the fight and starting out, I was like, all right, he better come out. He better come out he better come out and dominate. And I think him coming out with the crown, being carried out on the throne, I thought that spoke to his confidence. He knew he had some tricks up his sleeve. He knew he was going to come in better shape. And realistically, if you think about it, he didn't come in better shape. He came in heavier.
Mm-hmm.
But overall, he came in, when I saw he was heavier, I was a little bit skeptical, but then he was faster. He was more powerful. He had a better game plan. And where I really give a lot of credit to Tyson Fury, I didn't know this guy had the boxing IQ that he did. He really learned a lot of lessons from the first fight and took those lessons into the second fight and dominated. And I don't know, not to say Wilder didn't learn anything, but just speaking, I mean, what we saw, it looked like he learned a lot.
Yeah.
So that was interesting to me.
I was super shocked that Wilder just looked off the whole time. They talked about his equilibrium being off because, you know, of broken eardrums, that kind of stuff. And then this morning I've heard reporting of just a major scratch within the ear that was bleeding a lot.
That's exactly what I heard. Yeah.
At the end of the day, whatever it was, Wilder just didn't look good. He looked off from the beginning. He didn't have his steps right. His footwork was atrocious. He just looked confused. And granted, he took a couple big headshots. Shots, no doubt, and some good body shots from Fury, dude. Fury was really well balanced. I was really impressed with it. Just like I said earlier, his reflexes are still very dominant. His speed, punches, for being a heavyweight as big as he is fast, dude. Fury is fast. But that being said, like I said, going back to Wilder, he just looked confused the whole time, out of place. He didn't look like he had his legs,
I think since the ear shot, that definitely knocked him off. Like equilibrium-wise, yeah. You could tell his legs were just not really under him after that shot. And have you ever been hit in the ear super hard like that? Have you ever been popped in the ear with anything?
Oh, dude, temple?
Like a football?
I've been hitting the temple, and I can only imagine that's the same or worse. Right. Like, that shit hurts. Like, pressure points where you have that much pressure. Like, dude, you break an eardrum, you know how much pressure is packed into that?
But it does knock you off a little bit. Like, totally. It knocks you a little bit off of sorts, and I think that's exactly what we saw from Wilder. He just looked like he was staggering around a little bit, you know? So, did you watch when you were watching the fight, what was your thoughts when you first saw Wilder coming out? Did you think, okay, he's going to hit him with the big shot? You're just waiting for him to kind of pull the trigger on the big shot.
I was waiting for him to take it to him, but it was just crazy because
he just never
Fury
did.
Came out from the beginning and just took it to him. Like, he just stepped
and
he fought so
smart. I saw my man Brian on Twitter, and we were kind of going back and forth, and I saw his tweets, and he was just like, throwing all the weight on him. I mean, he didn't do any of that in the first fight. Mm-hmm. In the first fight, Fury looked like he was a little bit tentative and didn't want to get caught with the big shot, so he wasn't going in close.
Right.
This time, it's like he went all the way in and didn't give Wilder a shot to really cock back and hit him, because he was so close to him and on top of him in a smothering mode, and he just kept grabbing him and dragging him down and suffocating him and putting his weight on him.
And that's a lot of weight.
At any point, if he gave him a chance to get that big punch,
could have been over.
Could have changed the fight.
Exactly. Yeah, and never got a chance to really cock back and release. And by the time you knew it, third round comes, he gets popped in the ear. After that, I thought in the fifth round, bro, I thought it was a wrap. And I had taken in a ton of action. I had taken in some round by round action, bro. Oh my God. I was shitting my pants. I had taken in round by round action. So I was praying when I took in this action, I was thinking the fight will go the distance. Nobody's going to lose in rounds. I thought Fury would fight him in a similar way. I thought it would be similar, but I thought he'd do enough boxing. And for me, looking at Deontay Wilder, I don't think he's a fighter that's ever going to win a decision. He's a knock-you-out guy, or he loses. He's not going to do enough to box you like a traditional boxer to win on the scorecard. Mm-hmm. He's got to knock you out. So I thought Fury, as I predicted last week, was going to win the fight, but I thought it would go to a decision, and he would win by unanimous decision, split decision, something like that. So I was taking in all this money on the round by round action. Well, dude, as Wilder starts getting weak, bro, I'm standing up. My heart, I start sweating.
Yeah,
my shit is pounding. My girl's like basically passed out on the couch next to me. And I'm like this, cause it's like 20 bucks to win a grand, 20 bucks to win 1,200, 20 bucks to win 2 G's, you know? So there's a ton of round by round action. So these dudes are putting down a $20 bet to win $1,000 if Tyson Fury finishes him in the fifth. And I'm thinking, oh, he's done. There's no way he's making it out of the fifth. The sixth, I had on the first and second round. Then I had on the fifth. And then I had on the 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th. So the only rounds I was safe was the 3rd, the 4th, the 6th, and 7th. And he knocks him out in the 7th. I was shitting my pants, dude. But I was safe, baby. I was safe. I was safe in the 7th.
That's tight.
So, yeah, dude, it was that was my – me watching the fight was a little sporadic.
I know. You and I were doing a little texting at the end. You're like, yo, check this out,
I'm
man.
I'm like, dude, this is getting insane, bro. Yeah. This is getting
20 to win 1,000. Man, I couldn't even house that bet.
Right. And Fury was the underdog. That's the thing. Fury was the underdog going into this fight. If you looked at those same odds on Wilder's side, it was like 20 to win a couple hundred, 300, 400, 500. You know, it was less than half. And Fury just looked like the dominator in that match. So here's what I'll ask you guys. As we know how it came out, let's first get into the towel being thrown in.
Mm-hmm.
What did you think of the corner throwing the towel in? Saving Wilder and kind of calling the fight?
I'm with their corner for sure. Obviously, that's been his trainer for quite some time. His trainer knows best. But the other crazy thing is his trainer's never had to do something like this. So I think this really kind of showed us, like, hey man, we're really, you know, we had a couple deaths, I think, last year. I mean, it was like every two or three fights, man, it seemed like a boxer was dying, dude, like days after their fight, after their Saturday night fights. So for me, knowing that and not being a big fan of boxing by any stretch. I would rather watch UFC any day, and I have more vested, right, interest in UFC personally. So for me, knowing about those stories and how, you know, 2 to 3 days, you know, these people were dying and it was like every 2 or 3 weeks, dude, I'm super happy because there's nobody that knows their fighter better than the trainer, or should be, right? So I think that was the absolute greatest move. And as I kind of ran some of these back and as they kind of did some replays that really showed us different angles, I was validated from those angles as well. Because when you're just watching the shot from like above, like how 90% of the boxing, you know, match is, When you saw those other shots, those other camera angles, I'm like, oh damn, I didn't know it was that crazy.
Like I told you, I didn't think he was making it out of the fifth. Yeah. I thought at that point I was like, oh no, you know. And I know there's going to be a lot of people on social media that say he should have been fighting. Deontay Wilder afterwards said, yo, I'm a kind of guy that likes to go out on my sword, man. I want to go out and I want to continue to fight. You
on
know,
my
I
shield.
Mm-hmm. On my shield. Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah. I hate that they. That they threw in the towel, and here, I actually have that audio. Let me.
That's what a warrior says.
Let me play that for you really quick.
No, I make no excuses tonight. I just wish that my corner would have let me win out on my shield. I'm a warrior, and that's what I do, you know what I'm saying? But he did what he did. It's no excuses, and we come back and be stronger.
So, him being the fighter, I think the fighter's always going to say, let me fight, right?
Yeah.
Fighter's always going to say that.
Bet.
I'm with you. I think a lot of people are giving, what's that dude, assistant trainer? Mark Breland is his name. He's the assistant trainer. He's not even the head trainer. I thought Jay Diaz, the head trainer, was a little bit bush league to throw it on. They asked him about it after the fight, and maybe it was just knee-jerk reaction. Maybe he was caught off guard in the moment, but he put it on Mark Breland. He kind of was like, kind of pushed it off like, oh, he did it. He decided it. Instead of like, Breland was like, yeah, we're a team. We run this like an NFL team. We make a discussion and we make a move. Doesn't matter who throws in the towel. You know what I mean? It's not Breland's decision to throw in the towel, but I'll give Breland credit because he did throw in the towel. He saved the guys. I won't say he saved his life, but he saved him a lot. He saved him the ability to be able to walk out of that ring on his own power. He saved him the ability to give the cut we just played and allow him to talk at the end. Because I don't know if you leave Wilder in there, I don't know that that's happening. I think he's getting knocked out and he's not. I don't know. He might be leaving the place on a stretcher in an ambulance.
We didn't need to see that. Yeah.
Not necessary.
Totally. But I didn't like a lot of those comments, like what you're saying. And then even from Wilder being like, you know, my trainer should have did this. It's like, you guys should be a united front. He should say, I want to go out on my shield. But
right.
It seems like everybody's just throwing the blame to the next guy.
That, you're so right. I don't know right. Yeah.
There's much unity.
And I think you should be giving credit to Mark Breland. Like he saved the man a lot of trauma.
For sure.
You know, there's no way. And it's very hard because this is the ultimate comeback fighter. Deontay Wilder is he's that knockout punch power fighter. Those are your ultimate comeback fighters because they can turn your lights out at any moment. This just was not that kind of fight. There was no way he was coming back. He didn't have his legs under him at all. I don't think he had knockout power anymore. By the time they threw the towel in, the knockout power was gone.
Yeah,
there was nothing he was going to do to win that fight other than take a bunch more damage and go to a decision and lose. Mm-hmm. You know, if it gets at best case scenario, absolute best case scenario. So where we go from here, Deontay Wilder, and by the way, all the people on social media saying this fight was fixed, you guys are idiots, absolute morons. Okay, absolute morons. If you see somebody saying that this fight was fixed, saying that Wilder didn't throw the hands on purpose, they're trying to set up another, they were already contracted to do another fight. Do some research, okay? They were contracted to do another fight already. This was already gonna happen. We talked about this last week. They already had the rematch clause in there. So here's where I go with that. Sorry, quick burn on these fools real quick. Here's where I go on that. Do you wanna see Wilder Fury 3 run it back right now? Or do you think there should be another fight for Tyson Fury and then Wilder should fight someone else and then maybe they run it back as long as they're going to run it back at some point. Mm-hmm. But do you think there should be something in between?
I think there should be for Wilder especially. You know, you would hate to see Fury.
What if he loses, though?
Yeah, I know. That's right. The thing. And but I think he's got to kind of earn that back. And I don't want to say that him just losing, especially when they had a draw, and then him coming off this loss with Fury. I'd like to see Wilder kind of get some stamina back up and fight somebody different and get his confidence back up. Let's be honest here. Now that brings Anthony Joshua into the equation. Mm-hmm. That brings you know a couple others that we could think about. But Anthony Joshua obviously is the one that's coming to everybody's head first. But I would love to see Wilder fight somebody else before they run it back. Mm. That's kind of my opinion with that.
What about with Fury? What do you think Fury does?
With Fury, I don't know what he does. I'd like to see him keep up the momentum. I'd like to see him fight, not very quick, but I would like to see him fight in the next, 4 to 6 months.
You know what I think? I think there's money. Obviously, there's money.
Yeah.
There's big money. Let's call it big money in the rematch, in the Wilder Fury match. Even with the way Wilder lost, it would be a lot more money had it been closer fight. Mm-hmm. But there's still money there. There's still money to be made. But I think the big money now, the next big money fight, and I'm talking big money outside of Vegas, Anthony Joshua, Tyson Fury in Wembley Stadium.
Oof.
You go overseas. You put 90,000 in that bitch. Wembley Stadium, pay-per-view, Anthony Joshua, Tyson Fury. If you remember back in 2017, Anthony Joshua beat an old beat up Vitaly Klitschko in Wembley Stadium, and they packed the place.
Now, yeah.
So you're telling me if he can pack the place with a guy on his Vladimir Klitschko.
There you go.
If they packed the place with Klitschko on his way out with his final fight, because he retired shortly after that fight, after he got his ass beat, he got TKO'd in the 11th by Joshua, I believe. If they can pack it with that, you're telling me Tyson Fury and him can't do some crazy numbers in that place?
Oh, dude, especially
pay-per-view buys, 90,000 Wembley. Dude, that's the
Wembley's
that's the fight.
The local boy Fury?
That's the fight. For me.
Yeah.
For me. That's how I'm looking at this. I think it's gotta be Anthony Joshua. And if you're me, I think you take it out of Vegas. Mm-hmm. You take it where it can be a little bit bigger spectacle. You go WWE, if you will. You know, they take WrestleMania to these football stadiums. Mm-hmm. They take it out of indoor arenas. You know, a lot of their pay-per-view events they have in basketball arenas, hockey arenas. They take it out of there for WrestleMania, for SummerSlam, sometimes for the Rumble, some of these bigger events, and they put it in a football stadium or something like that. I think they need to do that with with this boxing match.
I think that breaks records. I think that's record-breaking. Those two in Wembley? Oh, yeah.
So
we've never seen numbers like that.
I think that'd be a fun time. And that's kind of where I go with that one. Mm-hmm. I wanted to get my man Ed with Sports Plus Life podcast come on today. He could not make it work with the schedule. Just talk about all these fights and particularly the UFC stuff coming up. I saw him tweeting out some stuff. Can you pull up on ESPN MMA Instagram? They had a picture of Paul Felder and Dan Hooker side by side in stretchers.
Mm-hmm.
You can either probably Google it I know it's on ESPN MMA's Instagram. I saw it on there. Put that on the screen for these folks as we go into this UFC clash here. The UFC Fight Night 168, Felder Hooker was the main event over in New Zealand, mm-hmm. Auckland, heavy Dan Hooker house over there.
Hometown boy.
Right? Heavy. So Hooker, Paul Felder was getting no love in there.
Mm-hmm.
But you were telling me about the women's fight.
Yes.
Tell me about the women's fight before we get into that one, because I didn't see the women's fight.
Oh, you didn't?
I went back and ran back the Felder. I was so locked into the boxing shit on Saturday night
mm-hmm.
that I didn't even really know there was a fight night going on
mm-hmm.
until afterward. And then I saw, oh shit, Felder's fighting. I love Felder.
Oh, yeah.
And then I saw it was a war.
I love his commentating. Right? I love him as a fighter. He's great. Both sides.
So yeah. And then I saw it was a war, and I was mm-hmm. like, oh man, I got to run this back. So I went on ESPN Plus after the boxing match.
Mm-hmm.
I went on ESPN Plus and ran back that fight, and holy shit, dude.
A war.
Is it too early to say fight of the year? MMA? Holy shit.
I don't know if it's too early. That was a war.
That shit was insane. If you did not see that on Saturday night, look at these dudes stretchered up, both of them having trouble leaving the octagon. It ended up going to a decision. I thought multiple times both guys were going to be knocked out in the fight. No, crazy, dude. Actually, yeah, we'll hit this really quick since he got that up.
Yeah, might as well.
Did you see the fight, number one?
Yes, I saw. Well, I saw a lot of the replay stuff.
Okay.
So I didn't watch the fight, though.
Dude, early on in the fight, Hooker's jaw got broken.
Saw that.
And it was absolutely disgusting. I could not stop looking the rest of the fight because he, from about the third on or whenever it got broken, he kept getting punched in the jaw, dude. And it looked like his jaw, it was just hanging open, dude. It didn't look like he had no control over it. He couldn't, it didn't look like he could close his mouth. And then did you hear him at the press conference afterwards? My man could barely even talk, dude. They tried to interview him. And he could barely, and between his accent,
yeah,
he's from New Zealand, between his accent and his broken jaw, you couldn't even understand what he was saying. But anyone in the chat, if you guys saw this fight, did you guys, did you guys think Paul Felder won the fight? It might have been me just being an American and being wanting Felder to win and liking Felder a little bit more. But gosh, dude, I just felt like Paul won that fight. I felt like Paul won it, but... You know, I'm not going to get mad. I mean, it was splitting hairs. Mm-hmm. It was absolutely insane. But did you hear Paul Felder after the fight? This was very sad, man. He talked about maybe leaving the octagon and being done. And I understood where he was coming from, dude. I watched this fight with my lady, dude, and we were like, this is what a war. Mm-hmm. How do you go through that and then someone has to lose?
Yeah.
How do you get that effed up and put in that performance and then someone still has to lose? I felt so bad. I don't know if I felt worse for a fighter having to lose at that point,
and had to sustain that much damage.
Right,
incredible.
And dude, so I was thinking that, and then I hear his interview in the ring afterwards, and I was like, I felt even worse. Look, listen to this.
Let's have a couple of words with you, my friend. Hard fought battle. You gave everything you had in there. What was the feeling going to that judge's decision?
I knew it was close. I feel like I hurt him a lot in the fight, but he got the takedowns, he was smart. He busted me up pretty good, and that might be it for me.
You hear that crowd reaction to that? They love you, man.
Man, I got a four-year-old at home that misses me every time I go away like this.
I wish we could show the video. He has just busted the hell up too, dude. Like, just busted.
I don't know.
Dude.
Thank you, man.
Dan.
Well, congratulations to Dan. I mean, I knew this is exactly what I was in for when I came up here to New Zealand. I pissed this guy off, you know. And when you piss off a talented guy like Dan, he's going to bring it to you. And, man, that was fun, brother. That was fun. Five rounds going at it. I'm not sure, you know, I'll still go back. I'll talk to my family, but... an absolute honor to come in here and share the octagon for 25 minutes with this
dude. I wonder what was said. I didn't catch the post-fight press conference, but what happened at the beginning of the fight? This was interesting to me. They come out and the referee gave all the instructions on what to do. Touch gloves. Felder puts his gloves up. Hooker goes like this, puts them behind his back and backs up to the cage. And immediately the announcers go, oh, there we go. They didn't say bad blood, but they said Felder with some comments before the fight must have struck a chord with Hooker.
Yeah.
And I don't know what he said. I was wondering if you saw that. No?
Didn't see it.
There was something said, and that's what he alluded to it there again in the post-fight press conference. Felder this time, he said, I came up here, I pissed this guy off, and I wonder what he did to piss him off. That's why I want to talk Sports Plus Life, someone that knows what the hell's going on. Mm-hmm.
Here's what I would say about Paul. I would hate to see him leave, but again, he's always going to commentate. I think he's really kind of found a niche with that. I think he's doing very, very well with his commentating a lot of these fights here over the past, and will continue to do that. Do you know he's only 34? That's still fairly young,
yeah,
in MMA. And if you look at it, so right now he's 17 wins, 5 losses. And if you look at, you know, some of the last, like, you know, 3 or 4 events that he's done, obviously he lost to Hooker, but his last win comes off of Edson Barboza. That's a great win. You look at the one before that, that was a win versus James Vick. And then previous to that, he did take an L against Mike Perry, which who hasn't been doing very well. You talk about somebody aging in the UFC.
Yeah,
Mike Perry is
no
one of those guys.
Not what he
so, you know, he's coming off still a pretty good record because, and this is a neat kind of comparison when we talk about the women's division, because it's a whole nother conversation. But, you know, Paul, I get it. The whole family thing, the daughter, he's emotional after that type of loss and after that type of brutal fight. You know, I think you'll see him fight another time or two. I really do. But I think really he's kind of going to go into that next form of life, right? And commentating, I think that's kind of his next big thing in his wheelhouse. So we'll see what happens, but he's a dog, man.
No
he
doubt.
Is a dog for sure.
Such a fun fighter to watch too. Let's go to the women's fight really quickly. Yeah. I didn't see that one. You were telling me, because I was like, dude, do you want to talk about the war this weekend, UFC? Yeah. And you're like, oh yeah, dude, I heard she couldn't even, she had to go to the hospital. I'm like, wait, she? What are you talking about?
Yeah.
You're like, bro, the women's fight. And I was like, what? I didn't even see this.
This women's fight was crazy, man. Just a knockout, punch out, drag out.
I had to run this back.
Yeah, very similar to the Hooker and Felder fight. I really thought, you know, you saw a lot of different things, but again, this was a unanimous decision. So there was no knockouts or anything like that. These women just beat the hell out of each other. So I'm referring to Karolina and then Yan. So Yan, dude, is so good. Her record right now is 12-1. Karolina is 12-6. And the problem with Karolina right now, with this loss, this now makes her fourth loss in a row. People are already talking about, hey, should you throw in the towel? Is it retirement time? You know, she lost against Yan this recently, Grasso, Watterson, and then Andrade. So really in that weight division, there's nothing really that she can prove. So people are like, where are you going to go now? Just let go of this. So that's kind of a little backstory here. But when we go into this, I think I sent it to you. I don't know if I sent it to Jalal, but the video, she came onto her Instagram and kind of talked about the fight and some of her health issues with it. But we're talking like broken orbital bones possibly in her face, dude. She had no sight. So first of all, she said she had double vision at the end of the fight. Then she had no vision. And long story short, she is still at the hospital and they will not let her fly out because of her injuries that she sustained. So a crazy, crazy situation, man. And I haven't seen a beatdown like that in a minute, man. She sustained so much, just so many injuries, dude. She just looked, man, she was beat up, dude.
Let me, this is another kind of one of those situations, right? You just hate to see someone lose the fight.
Uh-huh.
On something like that. This is a video she put up on her Instagram. You have it, Jalal, or no?
No, I didn't.
I think it's in the notes right next to, right next in the first block. Yeah, I have the Instagram. Yeah, just pull that up there. And I also,
I see it.
Cool. Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Good shit. And then, yeah, I want people to see. Yeah, we won't get clipped for copyright on this shit. On the UFC stuff, we get clipped, so we got to kind of, you know, pull it down with the video and stuff.
Hi, guys.
But
thank you for your support. First time in my life after fight, I cannot say that I'm okay. Like you see, I in the beginning of first round, I have broken small bone here, and eye nerve stuck there, and I couldn't see nothing. My vision was double, and everything was like in the fog. Yesterday after fight I spent whole day in hospital. Today I going to specialist and they make decision because I need operation, and I'm waiting for decision here, or I can back to Poland and make this operation in Poland. But doctor said I have to stay here because flying with this eye is very dangerous.
Wow. Holy shit, dude.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah, it makes you just think about, kind of makes you think about fighting in a different way, because there's so many guys that just, and ladies, that go in and out of the octagon and everything is straight.
We don't see anything after the fight a lot of times. We see a presser, but we don't see them getting taken out in stretchers usually. We don't see them going to the hospital to get checked out.
Probably in wheelchair, CTE, getting wheeled in to go do physical therapy,
dude,
ice bath.
These fools, I mean, the last couple of fights we've seen in the UFC that have been absolutely
just wars,
badass.
Yeah.
Dude, people limping out of the octagon, having to be walked out of the octagon, assisted out of the... Dude, it's brutal.
It is, man. It is, and it makes me think. I wonder, like, obviously, this wasn't really around when I was a kid. You could go get in karate. You could go train and maybe do some kind of mixed martial arts and stuff. But there wasn't really UFC or cage fighting. These kids that we see growing up now, how many kids do you think see this on TV? And be like, yeah, I want to go do that instead of playing football, instead of playing traditional sports. Isn't that interesting? And we're going to see the next crop, how great, like we see some great fighters now. We're starting to see it even more and more, how these guys are better and better and better. And the skill level is just higher and higher and higher. Imagine what it's going to be like as these young kids now get into the sport that have been doing it their entire life.
Crazy.
You know, that have been putting everything into it. So I think it's going to be wild as hell, man. As we move on, let me get to, Dude, two fight Daniel I for the haters.
Nice.
$20. Shout out. Thank you, yeah, bro.
According to the chat, there's some good haters in there. I apologize. I'm not paying attention.
Is there people hating? Shit. Well, if you're going to, every time someone hates, I swear to God, if you just tip us some money, and I bet you they'll stop hating really fucking quick.
Should I put him in timeout or should I just remove him? What do you think?
Whatever you guys want. I don't really care.
I feel like timeout is more like,
some kid demeaning. Shit.
It's more demeaning. Oh my God.
You folks want to go to timeout?
That shit is, oh my God.
You know what it does if you put him in timeout?
I have no idea.
They can watch, but they can't comment.
Bro, I don't know how any of this shit works. If I did, we'd have a lot, you know, stuff would be going crazy.
Oh.
I just come here and do the
Doug.
Show. Well, oh, how shit. Shoot this real quick, Dal. Shoot
all right, this is for the 20?
Let's go,
come
Dal.
On, baby. Come on.
Knock it down, Dal.
Kobe.
Oh,
I got it in there.
There we go. Finally.
Yeah.
Hey, I couldn't let anybody down. You know what I mean?
With the Kobes. Nice,
let anybody down. You know what I mean?
Good shit, dude. Hell yeah. John King, I rock with the timeout. Good shit. Oh my gosh, my man Doug Geiger, Dougie Fresh, coming through $49.99 in the super chat.
I feel like we should sing the song.
What song?
Doug from The Hangover. Best Friends.
I think we should queue up the. Let's queue up the song.
Should we
queue up
that? Dal this week?
Oh yeah, is that, no?
You should
be
shot.
Rapping with Dal, but
since you made it, Dal, you get balls back.
Yeah, maybe we won't do rapping with Dal. We'll do we'll sing the Hangover Doug song.
Come on, Dal.
Come on. Two in a row, baby.
Throw it in, Dal.
Oh, too heavy.
It's all good, man. It's all good. I thought you had it. No big deal. We're gonna
take that L on the way up.
It's all good.
Got one.
What'd you say?
We got the little double action going here with UPS and USPS.
Do we?
We got anything coming?
This is for my man Doug. I don't think we do.
Okay.
What? Tigers dream of when we take a little tiger snooze.
Dougie Fresh.
Dream of mauling zebras or Halle Berry in her Catwoman suit.
We're in clip for copyright.
Don't you worry, your pretty striped head. We're gonna get you back to tigers in your cozy tiger bed. And then we're gonna find our best friend Doug. And then we're gonna give him a best friend hug. But if he's been murdered by crystal meth tweakers, well, then we're shit out of luck.
There you go, Dougie Fresh, baby! $50 in the super chat.
That was amazing.
Thank you, Doug.
Wow.
Hell yeah.
We can almost pay rent.
Love that shit. I'll be you, Doug. Love it. Thank you, Doug, man. That was badass. Thank you to everybody that donates in the super chat, man. Everybody that just comes in here, rocks with us. Man.
Yeah, even you haters. We couldn't make this money.
I wouldn't be getting $50 if it wasn't for people hating. I wouldn't be getting $20. I wouldn't be getting shit.
Yeah.
By the way, go check the lace swap on Instagram at OMG. It's TTF. It is sick as hell. I'm embarrassed hearing you tenors sing this. That's fine, children, man. That's fine, bro. Rock chalk. Rock chalk. $4.99 by T-Mobile for Dal hitting the Kobe.
Nice.
There we go. Thank you, T-Mobile. Thank you, John King. I'm singing at my desk. Oh, damn. I want to see video of that, bro. You better put that on your story or it didn't happen.
Come on. Come on, John.
I need to see that in the office.
I'm locked into your story, man. Great review on the NC Jordans, dog.
John King has good content on his story, bro.
He's getting there.
I do this, and I don't even have content like that. He does this. Like, great job. Great job, John King. Good content on his story. T-Mobile, he didn't do it for you.
Take that L on the way up.
Damn it.
That looks solid. Damn it. From right here.
Look at Doug said, don't sing the song. Doug, it's too late, bro. I mean,
he's on the delay.
Yeah, he's on the delay. He didn't even want the song. Oh my gosh. I'm dying. I'm dying right now. Let's do this. Yeah. This is a perfect time to. Damn it, dude. I didn't click record on the audio today, Jalal. I'm going to need you.
Yeah, I got it.
I'm going to need you to come through. Let's go into On This Day, brought to you by Fortify Luxury Tattoo Aftercare. It is a CBD tattoo aftercare product. You've heard us talk about it on the last few episodes of the show. You've seen it on my IG. If you're looking to get a tattoo, you're looking to heal up your tattoo properly, man, check out the product, FortifyTattooAftercare.com. Use the code. What is the code?
Is it MUP?
MUP10.
MUP10, yes. MUP10. and save yourself a little bit of money on the website, FortifyTattooAftercare.com. Better way to heal and protect your tattoos? Look no further than CBD-infused Fortify Luxury Tattoo Aftercare. Our products are all natural and infused with the highest quality Colorado-grown CBD. Clients love Fortify because it reduces redness, inflammation, and helps their tattoo heal properly. Artists love it because it's perfect to use throughout the entire tattoo process, as the vitamin E and CBD assist with glide without ruining stencils or clogging tubes. Visit FortifyTattooAftercare.com to learn more and to purchase yours today. Also, use the code MUP10 to save 10% off your order.
All right, y'all. So on yesterday, because I think it's a momentous occasion for us here on the cast, we've talked about this individual many, many times. So on this day, February 23rd, 1999, rapper by the name of Eminem released the Slim Shady LP, man. One of the scariest, like, covers, the darkest imagery. And when I went to my mom and say, hey, mom, I need this album. And she says, well, let me check it out. Let me check it out, son. She's like, there's somebody dead in the trunk.
On
and
the
I
cover,
said,
yeah.
And I said, what? I just need the album, Mom.
Did she really? She caught you on
that? Oh, dude, she would not. And she saw that big fat parental advisory on there.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
And where I come from, where we had to drive 2.5 hours to a Hastings music shop to be able to get an album, my mom was, you know, too religious, looked too deep into it. Too deep, man. Too deep.
I didn't get caught. I got the album, but I just chucked it in the cart. I was like, I'm getting the CD.
Oh, you're smart.
And I put it in there with the track list up, front side down. And my aunt copped it from me. Not my Aunt Berta that listens to this cast, my other aunt. And shout out to my Aunt Berta, actually. Happy birthday. It was her birthday yesterday.
Nice. Happy birthday.
Yeah, dude. So my aunt copped it for me, and I was in like sixth grade. I have vivid memories of this. I remember bringing it to class in sixth grade. Probably we got suspended from school if I got caught.
Yeah.
But we were in band class. Me and my friend Andy, we were the percussionists.
Oh, nice.
So we would just be up in the percussion area while she was testing out all the flutes and all the whatever. Just
dicking
TTF around,
on
dude.
The kick drum. Come,
yeah,
come.
Exactly.
On the kick drum. Yep. TT.
Dude, I was on the big bass drum, the kick drum, the xylophone, the bells, the glockenspiel, whatever you needed, bro.
The glockenspiel?
The triangle. Yeah.
All right.
You don't know what the glockenspiel?
I need to get one in here in the studio.
Join band class, bro.
We're gonna remove this symbol here and get a glockenspiel every time somebody donates.
That would be sick.
That's what we're gonna do.
That'd be dope. So yeah, man, I was listening to it in band class. Like we would each have an earbud. We would just be each having an earbud. We'd just be listening, like
sharing buds.
This fool is crazy. Like just trying to catch everything that he was saying and trying to catch all the references.
Yeah.
And you're a young kid. You're in sixth grade, so you're not, you know, your intelligence level isn't there yet. You're not fully understanding every single thing about that he's talking about.
Oh, there's no way.
And I was telling, it was funny, Jalal and I were telling this, we're talking about this the other day. That album, the first two Eminem albums were so crazy because if you just go back and run back the instrumentals, there's probably five in both albums combined that you'd be like, oh yeah, I'd rock with this. The rest of them, if you didn't ever hear that and someone just threw that on for you and be like, hey, could someone make a song with this? Could a rapper make a song with this? Could this be a hit? Mm-mm. You'd be like, what the hell?
What is that garbage?
What the hell is that? You know, like everything from, you know, the one that's when I was just a little baby boy, mama, and so,
they're very like elementary, like just basic.
So basic, so basic. And, but that was the skill. That was the talent. You know, you make that into something. You take that and make that what it is. And I don't think I would have listened to most of those songs had he not just had the approached them the way he did.
The sick delivery,
you know,
that he had on
the delivery and the flow. Just something that I'll never forget, getting those albums. And it's really crazy about the Slim Shady LP. Do you know, so that's there's a lot of people that question, is that his first album? Is that his second album? Third album. So what happened is he released Infinite on like an indie label in 96.
That's right, yeah.
Way back in Detroit.
A non-big label, yep. Yeah.
Then he released the Slim Shady EP, which had a bunch of the songs, not a bunch, but some of the songs that you hear on the Dr. Dre produced Slim Shady LP.
Gotcha.
But the EP was released before he got signed to Dre. So that's what Dre heard, and that's what they chose songs off that EP. But since it's an EP, it's not an official album.
Right.
So technically, that's his second album, but it's his first to most people. Some people think it's his third, but it's not his third at all because Slim Shady EP is not an album, it's just an EP. So
gotcha. But Infinite though was his first Infinite, on 96. The independent label in 96.
Yeah, and that's why it's really weird. I always get that confused. I feel like the Slim Shady LP, I'm always like, yeah, it came out in 97. Came out in 97. It didn't. It came out in 99. The Slim Shady EP came out in 97. And the reason I always think this album came out in 97 is because the song 97 Bonnie and Clyde is on there. And I'm always like, 97 Bonnie and Clyde, the album came out in 97. Didn't. It came out in 99. But he put that on the original EP.
Makes sense.
So that's, there you go.
Yeah, love it. We just have another quick one real quick that was a quick one real quick. How about that? Today, on this day, February 24th, 1992, take a little trip back here. Kurt Cobain and Courtney Love get married on this day in 92. So for me, this was big in the way of like they had a daughter on the way who became with the name of Frances Bean, who was born, I think, that later that October. If I'm correct on that, I'll have to look that up. But this was big, right? You had two of the biggest grunge rockers at the time actually getting wedded, which was crazy because Courtney Love had her first, actually, she had her first album come out 2 years after that, which was actually a couple days before Kurt Cobain committed suicide. So on April 8th, which is when Kurt Cobain committed suicide, Hole's first album, major label debut album was coming out. And then obviously Kurt Cobain and Nirvana, just, I mean, the airwaves were crazy with Nirvana. So at this time, so you
have a lot more crossover, mainstream actress with mainstream rocker.
Yeah.
You know,
I think that's what it was. Yeah.
And Courtney Love was a little on the edge. You know, she, I won't say she wasn't, I wouldn't say she was like the white dress of actresses, you know,
she
was a little bit blackballed in the industry.
She was
as well. So that kind of gave that crossover and it kind of, I think, led way for more, a little bit more of that.
I think so. Yeah. And she obviously was doing some actressing at that time. You know, remember the People versus Larry Flint?
Oh yeah. Yeah.
That movie
that
she was in. She was, I mean, she was definitely in the limelight. She obviously came raw and aggressive and had this, notoriety of being kind of, you know, edgy and off the grain or off the cuff. But this was a big occasion for me, especially being one of the biggest Nirvana fans out there. Again, the Nirvana Live in New York, Unplugged in New York, was still, you know, one of my favorite albums of all time. So this was big for me. Again, two power couples within grunge, which, you know, people still hate calling that time grunge, but alternative music at this time, this was a power couple at that time.
In the chat, Neighborhood, was that Dre producing the beats on there? Dude, it was actually this duo called the Bass Brothers, Dr. Dre and Eminem. They all led a hand in producing the album. And I remember hearing that. I remember hearing an interview with Dre, and he was like saying he was kind of mentoring and teaching M how to produce a little bit. And M was kind of, you know, he would do things and help, try to help out and do whatever. But I remember him distinctly being like, it was the weirdest process because everything I had, he had music to. Like every beat I would throw on, he had something that went with it. He had something that could go with it. He would just have this notepad and he was just flipping through and he just had shit. And I remember pulling up this hard drive of beats and I don't even remember these beats. And I throw them on, I'm like, oh, this is whack, you know? And I'm about to close it. And I'm like, no, go back. And I go back. And it ended up being, I think, Guilty Conscience or something like that. And he's like, then this ended up being this. And he's just like playing in these beats that I thought were just duds. Like they were chucked way back in this file that I was never going to open again. Like, I'm not going to do anything with these. And M just went and ripped through that folder and made them hits.
Because M was just so unorthodox.
Like, right, he probably just, right.
He probably didn't even understand what M had for most of those beats.
Right. And it was on a behind the music type of show that I saw that interview, man. And yeah, just crazy, dude. Crazy.
It's kind of getting crazy, man. We're having a lot of haters today.
Oh,
we might have to make somebody the moderator because I can't even keep up.
Oh, I can't make you. Can I make you the moderator?
No,
oh yeah.
I'm the moderator, but like,
should I make someone else the moderator? Yeah. Cause I can't keep up with the chat, bro. I'm trying to do the show.
Nah, that's cool. But they're just popping up.
If somebody wants it, we'll, if somebody wants it, we can.
I'm just putting everybody in timeout.
Yeah, that's fine.
I just think that's funnier than banning them.
Eminem is a great producer, also produced most of Lloyd Banks' hits. He did Smack That with Akon also. Dude, yeah, he started, I feel like Eminem's show, that's what I was saying. The first two M albums, he lended in, he kind of jumped in and helped with production. That's why I think the beats were a little bit crazy, but when the production really got on point for him was like Eminem show between him producing his own shit. I think the, you know, they had the Sing With The Moment, the Aerosmith sample on that one. You had that was like the whole We As Americans time. You had the Mosh joint. You had the Superman joint. There was just so many tracks on that Eminem show album that were great production, you know, awesome production. So yeah, let's move. Let me see. Shit.
We got to get John King's donation.
What do you? Oh, John King's up here? Yeah, John King in the super chat. $9.99 in the super chat.
Y'all's mother should have opted for the oral.
Yeah,
please. That's a double deuce right there.
I'm for real though. People are hating, like, and I'm getting donations. I'm not even seeing the hate. I'm doing the show, and we're getting money in the chat. Like, who gives a shit?
All day.
Get that in there.
Hey, man. Let's go, baby. That
was smooth and fluid.
With the smooth, bro.
For the haters.
For the haters. There you go. Let's do this. Let me hit this really quick, and we'll jump into sneakers and fashion. Where are we at on time? Let me look at the clock here. Oh, we're feeling good. Yeah, we're feeling good. We'll hit this and we'll go into sneakers and it'll be perfect. I think we have some underrated news too. Yeah, we'll hit that as well. 42-year-old David Ayers. Did you guys hear about this story? The Montreal the Toronto Maple Leafs were playing the Carolina Hurricanes.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know that for all, I didn't even know this goes on, dude. This is all new to me. I don't know shit about hockey. I know what goes on when playoff time comes, but that's about it. I'm not a crazy hockey guy. I follow the Avs when they're good, and I watch the Cup. I watch the playoffs, but that's about it. Right. You know, some occasional bets on games, some stuff I'm following, whatever. You're required to have two goalkeepers, and then the home team is required to facilitate a third goalie, a backup goalie for either team.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that's how it goes in hockey.
The home team, though.
Like, this is 1967.
That makes no sense.
That's how it goes. So check it out. They're the home team, and he's a objective goalie, right? He's just the third. Mm-hmm. When does this ever happen? When do you ever hurt two goalies in one game and then need to have a third backup goalie come out?
I've never seen it.
Never, right? Well, this is when it happens. 42-year-old Zamboni driver.
Nice.
Dude. 42-year-old Zamboni driver David Ayers was sitting in the stands with his wife at the Scotiabank Arena when the Carolina Hurricanes goaltender James Reimer went down with an injury. The on-call emergency net tender in Toronto, Ayers left his seat and got dressed into half his gear. So he was at the game with his wife there chilling.
Mm-hmm.
Guy gets hurt. He goes down. In the off chance that something might happen to Carolina's second option, Peter Mrazek, he was going to be ready. Mm-hmm. So, dude, he's a Zamboni driver for the minor league, for the Toronto Maple Leafs minor league hockey team.
Oh, wow.
He's a Zamboni driver and facilities manager. That's what he does. For the Maple Leafs, they're called the...
Look at my guy in action.
Dude, the 42-year-old Zamboni driver. They're called the...
So he's like plays...
stops and...
He like manages like the G League or D League of hockey.
Kind of, right? Dude. Yeah, exactly. So he's on the... He works for the Toronto Maple Leafs minor league squad. Now he's sitting here about to get thrust into action. Midway through the second period, Ayers noticed his cell phone start to blow up. And what he didn't realize that Mrazek had been hurt in a scary collision with the Maple Leafs forward Kyle Clifford, and he was down on the ice. The next thing 42-year-old Ayers knows, he was walking down the tunnel and into the spotlight. So this is a guy that works for Toronto's minor league team. Now he's playing against Toronto as the goalie for Carolina.
No good. Not good.
How do you do that? So then immediately that people that have bet on the game, what if people have money on the Leafs? They're like, oh, you're kidding me.
No doubt.
You know, or I'm sorry, people that have money on Carolina, they're like, you're kidding me. This guy works for the Leafs in a sense. He works for
who's this guy?
Right, the minor league team of the Leafs. So he comes on there. Guess what happens, dude? First two shots, goals. Boom! He takes two shots, gives up two goals immediately. David Ayers.
Right through the five hole?
Right through, dude, where mama keeps the Thin Mints, above the top shelf, up above the shoulder.
You got 100-mile-an-hour whatever puck coming at you.
No shit.
For the first time or whatever.
Right. So, dude, he said in his mind after the first couple shots, well, I got to do better than that. That was it. That's his quote. And they end up going on to win the game 6-3. He gets a victory for Carolina. And guess, do you want to know what he gets for doing this?
For, yeah, money-wise or monetary value?
Yeah.
Probably not much.
It was wild fun, said Ayers, who will be paid $500 and get to keep his jersey.
Oh, not good.
He gets $500 and he gets to keep his jersey, dude. Oh, that's it. My How God. Weird is that? How weird.
To be a professional, that's crazy. Maybe he gets picked up.
Dude, no way. 42-year-old keeper. I just thought that was, I know, dude. I just thought that was a very interesting story. I thought that shit was hilarious.
Hmm.
So David Ayers, the 42-year-old Zamboni driver, thrust into action, gets his first action ever as an NHL goaltender, gets to keep the jersey and gets $500.
I'm sure he'll be on a press run tomorrow morning.
Nice job.
Hopefully.
That was...
Yeah, does he got a manager?
I don't think so, dude.
Hit me up,
I bet
guy.
You he's being... Let's capitalize on this
fame.
Let's try to get him on the show for Thursday. Can we see if we can book him for Thursday's show? We'll get him to interview him.
I'm on it.
DM David Ayers.
David Ayers.
The Zamboni driver for the Toronto Mallies guy.
A non-verified account.
A non-verified account. Yeah, he's got 832 followers.
Yeah.
The Zamboni driver for the Toronto Mallies.
That's a hell of a story, though, to tell your kids. Hopefully he's got some kids.
Exactly. And that's what he said, man. The experience.
Yeah.
The experience is what made it worth it. Not the $500.
That's tight.
All right, let's go into sneakers and fashion this week, brought to you by Pure Spectrum CBD. You can use the code MUP on Pure Spectrum CBD's website. It's purespectrumcbd.com. Save yourself a little bit of money. They have pet CBD. They have CBD for you. Dude, my lady's back's been super, super messed up.
Mm-hmm.
She's been doing this, the tincture, dropping it in her coffee in the morning.
That's what Robin does.
She's like, oh, it's been awesome. Because she's a normal, she's like, I have to take a leave. I have to take Advil because my back will start hurting around like 2-3 in the afternoon.
Oh, yeah.
She's like, the CBD's been a nice surprise. It's really helped.
So that's cool.
PureSpectrumCBD.com. Use the code MUP. Let's get into sneakers and fashion, Dal.
All right, man. I think we'll start off. First of all, let me give some shouts for this hoodie here that I just got in the mail here. One second, let me grab it.
Some shout outs. All right, new piece of merch.
Yeah, it's the latest and greatest from Fat Kid Deals, which, you know, I wasn't very in tune with their brand by any means. It's a young man who was a chef for a little while. He's an entrepreneur, does a lot of different things as side hustles. But, you know, he's not a fat kid necessarily, but the idea is fat kid, eating what you want, whenever you want, kind of being a foodie. That whole thing is where that comes from. And he's now built a brand out of this, kind of like Supreme in the way that he hypes it up and only does very, very limited drops. So I really like what he does. It's very, very basic stuff. This happens to be one of their most popular box logo shirts. A lot of their shirts, they put, you know, like maybe Donald Trump or Guy Fieri or whatever, and then they'll just put the box logo over their face or over their head, you know, and just kind of, you know, dual branding in a sense. So man, it's really simplistic. It's very nice stuff. So shout out to Fat Kid Mafia. Happy to have this, man. And anytime there's a box logo involved and I can support, you know, just a small entrepreneur, love it, man.
Yeah, it's pretty cool, man. So, it's pretty
nice. Cool, right?
Yeah.
Little black and red joint, very easy to wear. Super happy to have it, man. So again, support the small guys out there.
I think oh, dude, by the way, you guys haven't even seen. I just found something. Oh, fellas, I found something that's going to be awesome for a Most Underrated Monday merch drop. Dude, it's just going to be crazy. I can't wait to show you guys after the show.
Sick.
Mm-hmm. We can see if we can get them made, dude. They're so cool. We're going to have them mad limited because they're expensive, but dude, they're going to be... It is freaking cool. All right. Anyway, before we do that, let's hit the Finish Line raffle.
Oh, yeah.
Pull up your raffle on Finish Line.
Mine wouldn't load earlier.
Oh, no.
So I don't know what the hell is going on with it here.
What are you talking about?
It just wouldn't load. So I don't know if it was like somebody was on it or what the hell was going on.
Mine.
Is yours loading?
Click your ticket to see if you won.
Mine won't.
Peel to reveal.
I don't get the peel here. What do you got?
Dang bros.
Dang bros.
Dang bros. Oh, yeah. There we go.
Come on.
Today wasn't your lucky day.
Of course. There we go.
No, next time might be. There you go.
No dang. Raffle lost. Yeah. Men's Jordan Retro 1 OG Pine. Raffle lost. Go figure.
Wow.
Dang.
Shocker, bro.
Take Shocker. The L on the way up.
Dang Shocker. Bros are back in the clutch. It's crazy that I won this one here that we're about to look at on the Finish Line wrap raffle. So I made sure to buy it, even if I didn't want it, because I know that this lottery system with these raffles, it's got to help to buy more shit, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I bought them.
I think we would know for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, we don't.
That's what
know
I thought
sure.
with the Travis.
That's what you guys
didn't
do with the Travis.
Work out.
Did you guys buy Travis merch?
Yeah,
just to see if you would get access.
I
saw your tweet. Yeah.
I didn't buy it just to try to get access.
Dying.
That's the only reason why I bought it.
Really?
I did not want that.
I thought about that after I bought it, but I bought the hoodie just because I bought the skateboard hoodie, not the Nike Air one that came out later. Because I hate my Nike.
Because your experience with that already?
Yeah. Nice. So I bought the skateboard one thinking that it might be a different material or whatever, and I don't like the whole skateboarding as a crime because that was an OG Santa Cruz thing back in the day. I remember when they did the skateboarding is not a crime shirt, so I didn't vibe with Travis Scott's version of that. But I mean, I liked his logo with this one, and I mean the trucks were fire, the Spitfire wheels were fire. But again, I don't skate that much. It's mostly like transportation. I'm using a longboard or something if I'm doing any type of skating.
Yeah.
I'll just be real here because I'm not trying to fucking bust my balls. But I did like the hoodie, so I'm happy to see that hoodie. But at the end, after I bought it a couple hours later, I was like, you know what? Math says this might increase my chances. My odds are going to be better.
What are you going to do now? So you didn't obviously get lucky, Jalal.
No, I cheated a little earlier. I did mine before the cast.
What?
You talking about the pine greens?
No. I'm sorry. The
Travis Scott.
Yeah,
merch.
Travis Scott.
Oh,
merch.
Travis Scott.
What are you going to do now? Return it?
I don't really think
no,
you can.
No. They're sold out, so maybe I just flip it.
Flip it.
Yeah.
Flip it to Ochi.
You get the same hoodie you did?
I got the Nike SB.
You got the
one.
Nike Air one.
Oh, you got the Nike,
or,
see?
Nike SB.
Sorry, and I got the one with like.
Oh,
the,
that's good. At least we got
his,
different.
His trap,
yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Different
so we
hoodies.
Can, yeah.
The little head up top. Yeah.
I thought we got the same one, but.
Nah, I got
that's
the good one.
Nice.
All right, you fools ready to see the Yeezy Earths in person?
Yeah, I want to see these in person.
All right.
Let's see. Let me get a. Oh, wow, bro.
Oh, wow, bro. I like that reaction.
Dude. Yeah,
so,
I mean.
So much different than the pictures.
Shocker. They don't look like the stock photos.
Yeah, they're way lighter, right? They're more sand colored than doo-doo butter. I mean,
did any
still
of you guys
butter.
In the chat get these, man? Did anyone in the chat hit on the Earths?
Earths. Or did anybody else hit on the tailgates and try to get the regional exclusive?
Yeah, I don't. Well, my chat's not loading anymore. Is yours, Jalal?
Yeah.
Okay. I can't. I used to be able to scroll and shit. Now I can't even scroll or anything.
Misha got $4.99 down. He says, dang bros.
Dang bros.
Phil B says, dang bros loading.
Dang bros loading.
Like before you guys revealed it, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah.
Dang bros loading.
He kind of already knew what was up.
There you go.
Hold on.
Ah, damn it. I missed it.
Did he miss it? And you were off on the camera? Too?
I was off with the camera.
Oh, uh-huh. Well, then I guess I get to shoot it again, right? If you didn't have the camera on, it didn't happen.
That's funny.
So what do we do? Is there going to be a local SB shop that gets the Travis's next week or what?
Yeah, 303 Boards is getting them. So the 29th, that's the only one that has been verified. I don't know the satellite board shop, Image. I'm sure Image probably gets them, but 303, I think it was Travis Scott's website or somebody affiliated with Travis Scott. Maybe it was CCS that sent out most of the stores that are verified getting them. And 303 Boards locally is the only one that I saw on there.
Okay.
But dude, you got it. You got to assume the backdooring is going to be outrageous on these. You know, the local skate shops obviously aren't getting the special box, the special presentation. That was a Travis Scott exclusive on his own website.
Man, those are probably
gonna
be going for
so you're going to see the multicolored Nike SB box, you know, the reds and the greens and the yellows and all that. So you're going to see that box with your local skate shops. But I think that's just going to be a backdoored mess. Just let me just say it now. MUP cast. Isn't getting the Travis Scott dunks. it's not even a dang bro. It's just, that's reality. It's
not even a you know, dang bro.
It's not going to happen. Let me just be honest with you fools. Okay. I hate to bust bubbles here. So let's just look at these Yeezy Earths and make the best out of these because these have resale. I don't know if you saw that.
I did. And I'm confused
as to why.
Yeah. There's just really, really limited pairs.
Well, here's what I would say. So, yeah, not a lot of Foot Lockers. As a matter of fact, none of the Foot Lockers in Denver got this pair. So okay. It was Finish Line. So now that doesn't mean that Foot Lockers across the country didn't get them because there were some Foot Lockers. As a matter of fact, your boy Tom Stefaniak was in New York. It was able to just walk in and get a pair. It wasn't his size. It was a 12.5, which is a unicorn size, if you ask me. But a lot of Foot Lockers didn't get them, or I'd say not all Foot Lockers got them. So, yes, there was a little bit of more limited. And as you do this kind of, region exclusive, obviously that creates limitations as well. So, yeah, I mean, I think limited and I don't know why else. I don't really like him. I'm not a huge fan of him by any means.
Yeah, dude, it just seems like a shoe that I wouldn't like. I'm not a huge brown fan of brown shit anyway, but like your Travis's, you know, your lows, your highs, whatever, there's color blocking that breaks up the brown. Mm-hmm. This is just a piece of brown. Like the whole thing is just a brown shoe. Like from the bottom to the top, it's just all brown. I just would never wear that. If it was olive,
yeah,
I might be more in. But this is probably, for me, the least likely color of a Yeezy I would ever
Seems
rock.
Weird on the bottom, too, the yellow boost.
That's the only thing I really like.
If it was going to break up the color, it should be somewhere more
present. Here's what I think they should do. You're usually the creative one here.
Yeah.
So I'm going to give you your credit when your credit's due. Right now, it's my credit is due here. Check this out. So the yellow on the bottom, I love that. And if they could have done yellow dots on the back of the pool tab.
Yellow
and,
dots? Okay.
You know, and then maybe a yellow right here on the toe, like the toe cap a little bit yellow, or maybe like a little yellow patch on the toe. I think that would have added a little bit of balance and made this just a little bit better. It would have broken it up. Now,
yeah, I needed something.
It doesn't break up the prime knit, unfortunately. This prime knit reminds me of dingy-ass carpet. Say you buy a home, right, to fix and flip. And you buy a home that has had animals, dogs, cats, and the carpet was originally put in like 1978, and you're just pulling it out in 2020. This is pretty much what the carpet's going to look like. So I can't really get that out of my head. So for that, I think it's an easy pair to wear because of that color. It's so damn neutral. But for me, I don't know, man. The good news is it's not a brick. I can unload it. I can get rid of it. I think right now you're going to be able to make $50-$60 possibly on this guy, which isn't bad. I think some people are considering that a brick, anything $100. If you're not making $100 or more, you know, some assholes out there consider it a brick. But I mean, a Yeezy V2 right now, $350, especially that model, it's hard to make any money on a lot of these that have been coming out. So I think with that regional exclusive and, maybe more neutral and the limited availability, at least for Foot Lockers. So not all Foot Lockers and all Finish Lines and all Champs had them at certain locations. I think that's what makes it what it is. So,
what do you think about this pair, the 12, the size of the 12? Did you see the size in the 12s?
The resale in the 12? Yeah. That's the moneymaker.
Of course I don't go for the shoe. I don't think that makes me feel better, though, because it sounds like they didn't make any 12s, really. Sounds like the 12s are just
have to be
scarce.
Pretty limited, yeah.
So I probably would have lost on the Finish Line raffle anyway.
Yeah, you go.
So I'm telling myself to make myself feel better. Mm-hmm. I didn't go for it. but that's interesting to me that not even the 12 and a half, the 12 is the money size, as Anna Chop was saying in the chat.
It is.
So that's very interesting.
Typically,
$350 right now, dude, on StockX, that's an offer. You can sell it for $350 right now on a 12.
God damn.
Literally sell.
Wow.
Yeah, that's the kind of scarcity we're talking about on the 12. God. When the rest of everything else, you're talking $275 to $290.
I want to give you such a hard time, just like you gave Stringer a hard time. Oh, what? You don't want to make money, Stringer?
Right, right.
But I feel like you can't on a $350 V2.
Right.
But in this case, it's a regional exclusive.
No,
you should
know what?
You should have been in there.
You know what, though? Shout out to Justin Credible. Justin Credible said it. He goes for every shoe regardless, and he goes for a ton. Mm-hmm. Of every shoe, and he always says I spend half my days returning shoes, taking shoes back. Remember?
Yeah.
Oh, you weren't there. I was talking to him at Park Meadows when I met up with him. Mm-hmm. Dude, and he was just like, I go for everything, and I spend a ton of time just sending shit back. That's like not resale, not your bricks, but stuff like this. You just never know, bro. You just never know exactly what's gonna happen with V2s.
Yeah.
So I mean, that's the real learning here. It's not. Mm-hmm. It's not learning about the shoe. It's not learning anything else. It's learning just always go for the V2. Just always try to get it because you just never know. Mm-hmm. And the worst case scenario, you can return it.
Right. Because you know, because they're always going to sell out of stores. It may take a week. Those Yeez reels, I think, sat for about a week and a half at Finish Line.
And as much as we all hate them, mm-hmm. and as much as we all don't think they're good, somebody does.
And we're tired.
Right. And we're tired of them. Some people aren't. Somebody does love them because the resale wouldn't be $350 on a 12, $280 on a whatever. And $280 is not a ton, but $350 is kind of crazy.
That is crazy for Yeezy.
It's got to be a logistical nightmare for Adidas. Like just being in that game, you sell a bunch of shoes to bots. People don't want them. They send them back. What do you do then?
Redrop them, restock. They call it a restock, even though they've already been out in people's crisps.
Six months later, you do a restock. And if that's what they did with the Zebras, I have to say.
How many you don't want to send these to the outlets. So they got to.
How many times did they restock the Zebra? Was that five?
Right. Maybe.
That's a great shoe.
Yeah.
But that damn thing is now under $300, and that was one of the most, if not, aside from the V1s, that was the most sought after pair.
Yeah.
Of V2s, you know? Yeah. So.
Yeah, that's nuts, dude.
But yeah, so man, that's crazy to me. That's,
shout out to Justin Cred, though, by the way, for the ones. I didn't get to see him, so thanks, yeah. Man, if you're listening.
Justin Cred, he's looking out for us, man. He is.
Let's take this time. Let's slide those off.
Kay.
And let's get into these ones really quickly. The ones I got, the pair I got is awesome. This is better than the 12 and a half that I reviewed on the channel.
Mm-hmm.
This is better than the 12 and a half I showed you guys that I sold. I'm so glad I got a 12. I'm glad I got a really super buttery pair. I swapped these out with the laces from the UNC to Chicago. I mean, I keep saying that. From the UNC Off-White Jordan 1 this morning, and the match is just crazy.
Mm-hmm.
Now, here's what I'm wondering. Does somebody have these right now at their disposal? This Lance Mountain Jordan 1 SB. Does somebody have these at their disposal? And it would be amazing if you had a pair of these too.
Mm-hmm.
Once I got here, I realized I think these come with the exact same laces that are going to match this perfectly. I think your off-white Jordan 1 UNCs come with them, but they say shoelaces on them. And I'm pretty sure these Lance Mountain SBs, but my box is at home with my extra laces. So can somebody in the chat
those
confirm
laces,
to me?
They don't match the sock line?
No. They're darker.
Really? They're darker.
And I remember them because we did the on feet with them. We did the review, all that stuff. And I put them in here to do the on feet. That's the only reason I really vividly remember that, because I remember it's a little bit darker than, it's just a little darker. And I think it's this, dude. It's this dark. So now the real question is, I saw Mass Souls, which is T-Mobile.
Alexander might have him.
Maybe you got both?
Maybe you could let us know, bro.
Yeah, dude, if you got both, let me know. If you got both pairs, let me know if this is the exact same thing. But Danny B and T-Mobile, they run Mass Souls on Twitter. They commented on my IG this morning. We're like, why? I hate that they call it these UNC to Chicago. Mm-hmm. And we talked about that. They've changed it. It's now NC to Chicago.
Correct.
Why did they change it, or did they not change it, and all of everyone else had it wrong forever?
I think they changed it because I thought I remember seeing the UNC, and I think that was confusing. I think after a little while, Nike kind of saw that and just immediately changed it on sneakers all of a sudden to NC versus UNC to Chicago. And I may be wrong on that, but that's kind of what I remember. What about you?
Hey, Doom Fury, why don't you fuck off real quick, dog? Wearing camo shorts and snapbacks, what year is this, 2012? In the chat, dog. I need to go. Yeah, really, really quickly. Do I need to go buy new clothes? Like, I got to go buy new clothes for you to watch my show. Really? You're going to come in here like, and I'm not even wearing shorts. This is nonsense, my guy.
I'm wearing an old man flannel, for fuck's sake.
And a workout tee underneath. I can literally, I don't give a fuck what you think of my clothes, dog. Like, I do not care what you think. I like the clothes, so I wear the clothes, but I'm not going to go buy new clothes so you can like me, dog.
Yeah.
You're not gonna bully me,
Freaky L.
You're not gonna bully me or Freaky L to buy extra shit just so you can come watch my show. Oh, did you put him in timeout? Oh, okay, my bad. I just wanted to talk a little shit first.
I know they still want to watch, so yeah, we'll just put him in timeout.
Right. So anyway, yeah. The conversation that I think we can have here is Jordan or UNC. And Carolina
mm-hmm.
are different blues.
Different.
The Fearless up top is a Carolina blue.
Mm-hmm.
Jordan brand, what's interesting is they call them different things. They call this UNC, just like they do on the UNC Jordan 1 lows, any UNC high, they call that UNC, right?
Mm-hmm.
They call those,
the P-Rod skate shoes?
The P-Rod skate shoe,
yeah.
UNC.
UNCs.
I think that's the difference. We're looking at UNC blue and Carolina blue as the same kind of thing, and they're not.
No.
Nike looks at them as two totally different things.
Obviously.
You know what I'm saying? So on the PS, we're old in here. Get out if you're a little boy. Exactly. Old as fuck to bully me into wearing new shit. Get the fuck out of here. I think the UNC versus the Carolina is different. Carolina's on the Fearless. Carolina's on the Obsidians. The laces that come with... do you have those now? Do you remember, where did you do my Carolina laces from earlier? Did you throw them somewhere?
I think we put them in the box, yes.
I don't even, you know what? I don't know if it's going to show up on camera, so I'm not going to waste the time.
Yeah, it probably won't.
But the Carolina blue is different than the UNC blue. It's just different.
It is.
And the UNC blue is the blue that matches this UNC to, or NC, NC to Chicago.
You got it.
Perfectly. So that's kind of your difference there. I hope that helps. I hope that breaks it down in a combo. A lot of people are asking me in the comments, what laces are those? Where do I get them? Best answer I have for you, if you own the UNC off-white Jordan 1, you can get them out of your pack there. If you do not, you can get them out of the Lance Mountain Jordan 1 SBs. Other than that, I have no idea. I don't know what else comes with that at the moment, like off the top and without going through all my boxes and shit. I'm trying to remember. You asked me this morning, where the hell did you get those? Yeah. What do those even come with?
I don't think I have
And then you're like, oh, no wonder I don't have them.
I don't have any.
Because you don't even got the lances yet, do you? Or do you, were you trying to get them?
I don't have the lances. Right. I do have the P-Rods, and they're the lighter laces, so that doesn't work. But I don't have a lot with the blue laces, unfortunately. So, yeah, I don't have anything that would work.
That's I wish. Stay tuned to my story on IG later if you guys want to know, man. When I get home, I'm going to check the laces that come with the Lance Mountains and confirm that they are the exact same shade of blue that these are.
Yeah.
And then we'll go from there. What about Roleplay Supply, TTF? Roleplay Supply didn't have the Jordan 1 laces from the off-white collection in this colorway. They had some of them. I didn't see them in blue when I looked. If it's up there, you can correct me. But
they've probably been having some supply issues.
Oh, I saw that on their Twitter. Did you see that on their social media or something?
I think you told me about it.
Or maybe Dow did. Someone told me about it. Shit, maybe it wasn't either, you fools. So yeah, someone told me that, yeah, people with the coronavirus, with the China stuff, people are having some issues, man, some supply issues over there. But yeah, man, I know there's a couple different sites that sell the off-white ones, but I don't know about this shade of blue. You have to fill me in. I didn't see them on there. Okay.
Armando Silva says the Nintendo Switch ones.
Dude.
That would work.
That's a
Nintendo Switch blue.
That's exactly.
I like it.
Exactly what they look like. Underrated. Con Lee, why the hell didn't they give us extra laces? $1.99 in the super chat. Thank you, Con. Appreciate you, bro.
Hey, BLM, NGU, delete your message, huh? Well, hey, you know what? TTF's going to be a great teacher.
Jalal deleted it. Oh. Don't worry.
I put him in timeout the first time.
Damn it.
He came back, so then I just...
Jalal's trying to be nice. But
trying to keep these, you know.
I saw the comment on that fool.
I had time for the chat, man.
We're going to shoot for Conley.
Yeah.
We didn't even talk about coronavirus. We didn't.
There was
a lot going on.
A lot going on today. How deep are we right now? I'm losing track of the clock.
Hour 40.
All right, we got 20 minutes. Go ahead, Dal. Light it up real quick. Light it up real quick.
Nothing but net, fool.
Let's go.
That was a perfect backspin if I ever saw one.
Thank you, man.
We're getting it today.
Thank you, man.
Love it. I think we're going to see a lot of supply issues with products made in China for a while. I know. Did you see the stock market today? Took a tumble.
Wow.
I was going to start the show out with that today, but obviously the Kobe Bryant stuff took precedent. Mm-hmm. But yeah, the stock markets took a crazy tumble. Everything's just, it's going badly. Going very badly. Are we good on the UNC to Chicago's?
I think so.
Are we good with that? Check out my story. I'll let you guys know what goes down with the Lance Mountain laces later on IG. Let's go here. The Easter Dunks. Jalal, do you have those really quickly? I don't even think they're called Easter Dunks. You and I have just been calling them Easter Dunks.
Right.
Right? What are they called?
They are called the Nike SB Dunk High Spectrums.
Oh, man. I think
they're called.
Fellas, if you're looking for a pair for Easter, man, you got your cute little family pictures coming up. Mm-hmm. You got your kids. You got your wifey. She's going to make you wear a nice little pastel Easter type of shirt to church or out with the family. She's going to dress you guys in some shit. You need a pair of kicks to coordinate, man. If you're not up on it, I know a lot of you cats are smart. A lot of you cats are up on what's coming out. But if you're not, bro, if you're not,
ooh,
what about these?
Man, if you've also sold your Sean Witherspoons for $1,200 like I did, these are a great pair to pick up.
I love those, dude.
I think they're awesome.
Do they come with extra laces? Do you know?
I have seen the green that you see in there, and I have also seen a light blue.
Like that blue there?
Yes. Yeah, it matches that light blue.
Or the tongue tab?
Yep,
yeah.
Yep, same blue.
Dude.
So I think that'd be cool. And you do one blue, one green, I think is the play on that.
I got a polo that's this color of that midsole panel. Just rock that polo. Throw those on.
That'd be sweet.
Oh, man.
I think it's a great shoe, dude.
That is awesome. I love
those. Great shoe. The suede.
The gum outsole.
The suede looks pretty buttery on some of the panels. I think some of the panels it'll be not as nice. But man, I think I love the gum sole. I'm a sucker for gum sole, man.
No shit. That is good, dude. That is so good. You like them, Jalal?
I love them. I just don't like that outsole.
No.
Really? What would you
what
want? Just
mean?
The traditional.
I think I would have liked a gum bottom, but a white midsole.
Jalal, what? You just hurt my heart, bro. Look,
too much brown in there. I don't know.
What?
Especially with all the pastel colors, I feel like that just throws it off.
Oh, it messes you up.
Like
on
white
it?
And pastel would be.
I love it just because it's already going to be a tough shoe to keep clean with the upper.
Yeah.
The upper's tough already, dude.
You know what that gum sole reminds me of? It looks different than any other gum sole that I've seen. It looks like, because I just put it in a toilet.
Yeah.
In the bathroom after we remodeled it. It looks like the wax ring that seals the toilet.
Really?
That's what it looks like. Yeah, it looks like the wax toilet ring.
Oh, I know. Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
You know
about.
The little wax thing that you buy as the sealer? Yeah, dude, that's the wax. That's the wax ring color.
I see what you mean. I never even pictured it. What do you think? White? What do you want? White outside?
Yeah, white.
I never pictured it with white, but I'm not against white. I think white
gum on the
bottom,
but yeah.
Oh, white but gum on the bottom.
I don't think that makes sense.
Why not?
White with gum on the bottom. I don't think so.
Gum outsole?
Nah.
I guess that's why we're not up at Nike designing sneakers.
I guess.
He said why? I don't white with the gum on the bottom. I don't know how that makes sense. Dow.
Not as much.
I'm pretty sure we've seen
that. I don't know how
before.
That makes sense. I know. Like, just so,
that's a pretty common
he's
combination.
He's just so against it. That's funny. That's really funny. Yeah, so I like those. That's a great pair of Easter shoes for you fools, man, if you're looking for something this summer, this year. Do we have a release on those? Do we know anything about release date or anything?
March.
March.
It says, yeah.
But I mean, seen people getting early. Are they early pairs? Or?
So End Clothing dropped their stock of it for whatever reason. And then they also did a restock of some of the sizes that didn't sell out, obviously. And now everything's sold out from End. But that is one of the only companies that I've seen put this out so far. But it sounds like the general release is March.
Okay.
So
I'm excited for those. Really excited for those ones.
I have one more look.
Oh, you do?
To get you guys excited for these.
Let me see.
Let's see what you guys think.
One more look? Why are you chuckling, bro? Are they not good? Oh!
What do you guys think there?
I think that guy needs some help with his lighting.
Yeah.
How are you going to just use a desk light, guy? Like a dorm room light?
Shouldn't be the official photos?
That's about as good as Adidas official photos.
Yeah.
Did the Adidas factory get those?
I'm going to have to see these in hand.
You're going to have to see them in hand? Dude, come on, guy. I highly doubt they look that shitty, Jalal. What do you mean?
It's just, I got to see how that gum sole is,
yeah,
the color looks.
I think that guy's light is what he uses for his weed plants. It's not good.
It's interesting, though. Do you see, they are different toe boxes and different midfoot panels.
Well, because it's reversed.
Gotcha. I didn't see that on the other foot. All we saw on the other foot was one shot.
Some of the other pictures are nicer.
There you go. Come on. And you're showing us that. You're making us look. We're literally looking at someone. If someone just took a shit in the toilet, that's what you put up on the thing right there.
Hopefully they had a
wax. Yeah, just went to the bathroom. Let me put this up on the screen.
Hopefully they had a wax ring.
I like these insoles.
Yeah. Those are great. Yeah, the blue. Oh, dude.
See, everything's flipped. It's great.
See, I didn't see that. I didn't see both of them. Those look great.
Look at even the tongue is even flipped, which is cool.
Those are exceptional.
I think they're great.
Those are delightful. I got to have those.
Great looking shoe.
Yeah. I'm in on those. Love it. Love it. All right. Let's do underrated news really quickly. We haven't hit underrated news for a hot minute. Brought to you by SeatGeek. You can use the code on the SeatGeek app. If you use the code underrated on the SeatGeek app, it'll save you $20 off your purchase. If you haven't made a purchase on SeatGeek before, use the code underrated. You'll save $20 off of your purchase.
Woohoo.
Yeah.
All right. And under nudes. Figure, right?
I like it. Under nudes.
Oh, man. Let's get some nudes in here. Because they're better than these stupid comments from these haters. I got to tell you. So check this out. In underrated news, we have a new concert that was actually announced here recently. Have you heard of the new Lovers and Friends concert that debuts Saturday, May 9th? Do you know anything about this?
Nothing about it.
Well, let me tell you about some of these guests, and let me tell you about some of the guests that didn't even know they were going to be guests. So check this out. No. So not quite as bad as Fyre Festival, right? Okay, in this case, but... a lot of these artists came onto Twitter and said, hey, I know about the show, but there's no contract. There's no money. The checks haven't cleared yet. Okay. I didn't know about this.
Whoa.
So there's been a little controversy with this.
Fyre Festival.
A little bit in that way, right? Some of the guests include Miss Lauryn Hill, Usher, Ludacris, Lil Jon, TLC, and you have Megan Thee Stallion. You have, and then some old schoolers like Lil' Kim. What about Mace and Twista?
Oh, there we go.
So yeah, kind of look at this 112 Foxy Brown, Drew Hill.
If this is real, man, this is an amazing lineup.
Dude,
like
Drew Hill is back. Haven't seen those fools.
A good mix of old school, new school.
So you don't think it's real?
It is real.
No, it's real. But if they can pull off,
if they can pull it off,
yeah.
So apparently checks aren't clearing. So
yeah. So here's what happened. So Twitter descended into chaos earlier this week after it was announced that stars like Lauryn Hill, Usher, Megan Thee Stallion, and Summer Walker would appear at Golden Voice's Lovers and Friends Festival on May 8th. Many remained uncertain about the validity of the festival after Lil' Kim, Mace, and Twista took to their social media to state that they would not be involved with the event. However, Golden Voice later confirmed to Variety that the festival is actually happening. Our festival is 100% confirmed. Lineups are always subject to change, however, and things have changed. The event has even added a second date, May 9th, to the festival's lineup, which has seen a few adjustments. So this concert now, almost what would be a festival, is going on Friday, May 8th, and then into Saturday, May 9th now. And it's funny. Little Kim even came and said, hey, she goes into her social and she says, hey, the check is cleared. Praying hands, all that good stuff. She says, thanks, Uncle Snoop. Guys, if it wasn't for him, this would not be happen. But y'all know how much I love Callie and Uncle Snoop. See y'all May 9th, 2020. Tickets on sale tomorrow. So shortly after all of this controversy, it sounds like checks have been cleared, people have gotten paid, and things have been finalized. But before they obviously had these things finalized, they put obviously the roster out and obviously kind of raised some questions and have now extended it a day. So it was only going to be a single day festival. Now it's going to be a 2-day festival.
I think it had to be. Looking at that card.
A little bit of a rookie move.
That card is crazy, right?
I mean, looking at the card, could you see all that being jammed into one day? As a spectator, I wouldn't want to stand through all that in one day. Mm. That's too much to consume at one time.
I know.
You need that in at least a 2-day thing. I think it should be 3 days, but if you have those kind of big names.
Those are huge names.
But I guess you don't need to make it, I guess if it was that long, you couldn't have be at all day events.
Yeah. Are you going to see Monica? That boy is mine.
But still, but still though, even with that roster, who do you have going on at noon? Right?
Yeah.
I mean, that show, what is it? It's just.
I'd probably put Trick Daddy at noon. Baby, because I'm a thug.
I'm trying to
probably
think.
That one.
Let's get that. Let's get the rapping for dog going.
Yeah. Maybe because I'm a thug. What's next?
Let's see
all
who.
Day, every day.
Yeah, I don't know the rest. I just know that.
Okay. That's first stop.
What about Sean Paul? Da, 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 da. I don't know the words though.
What is that? Let's do it again.
I gotta know the words.
Are you doing Give Me the Light?
Yeah, that's it.
Just give me the light. Da, 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 da. Just give me the light.
There you go.
That one? Golden Voice looks like they're in the game. I'm looking at their website. They do a lot of shows.
Golden Voice Productions?
Now, is that a part of Snoop or are they in conglomeration with the likes of Snoop?
No, that's Oscar De La Hoya's music production, Golden Voice. Instead of Golden Boy.
Got it.
Okay.
I don't know if Snoop has anything to do with this.
Well, he does. He's a big sponsor, but I don't think he, like, if you look at the top of that, it says Snoop Dogg on top with Golden Voice and then Bobby something. Bobby Z, maybe?
Bobby Z.
See the top of that?
I don't see it on mine, but
it's all good. Yeah, so Snoop Dogg obviously is part of a presenter in this whole thing. So
there you go.
And that's why Lil' Kim said, hey, thanks, Uncle Snoop.
Thanks, Uncle Snoop.
Check is cleared.
Bill B says, is somebody releasing the Evian water for the festival? Remember the Fire Fest?
Oh, yeah.
He revealed his story of what he had to do to get the water to.
That was the worst. Yeah. Yeah. Remember, I forgot all about
the
that.
The guy was ready to get down and dirty.
Yeah.
You got it. Ready.
Every team needs somebody like that guy, man.
Yeah.
He's willing to do whatever it takes to get the job done.
He became a crazy meme. Was that last year?
Rest in peace. Last year. Rest in peace, Stringer.
I think cool guys, anything more you have that you want to hit on for the show? People are like the rapping for Dow.
Nice. I wish I had more.
I thought he was having a seizure. Blake,
are we still speaking the Dingbos?
Should we do that on Thursday? For some reason I thought today was Thursday. It's Monday. You have it ready?
Not the shirt, just the logo. The shirt.
We should put it on a shirt first.
Yeah.
Let's do it on Thursday.
All right.
Thursday, we will have the sneak peek of the Dang Bros shirt, and I think it's going to drop next Monday, right? Most underrated Monday. We'll have it ready to go for next Monday.
Yep.
Dude, we could probably have a week. We should have a sample by then. We should have it ready to go. Dang Bros.
Mm-hmm.
The Dang Bros tee is it's dope. It's dope. We'll give you guys a look at the tee on Thursday's show.
Yo, do you guys notice the thumbs down?
What is it?
It was at 12, now it's at 3.
Oh, really?
What is it, like some spam bots?
Probably.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Spam bots.
They don't want us to win, bro. Studio time for Dal. Soccer Nate, $1.99. Let's go.
Oh, man.
Studio time.
Give me something to freestyle. Let's see.
I don't know if $1.99 is going to
There you go.
Gonna get you in there.
There you go.
You might be able to lay like a bar down.
A bar down.
A solid bar.
Just give it a
Off the backboard.
Let's go.
Oh, Duncan.
Man, I'm feeling the heat right now.
We out here. Out here, bro. There we go.
Tim Duncan in the cut.
Dang, what a tease. Dang, bro, what a blue ball. Is that... I just wanted to throw it on a shirt for you guys instead of just show you the logo, man. I want to show you guys a finished joint, ready to go.
And who was the one that said we should do that on a shirt? I feel like they should get a free shirt. If anybody specific, was it T-Mobile? T-Mobile, was it you?
Somebody said Dang Bros, it should be a shirt.
Yeah, I think if it's T-Mobile,
the Dang Bros.
Whoever, let me know in the comments.
Back in the live chat.
Yeah, because I'd like to know. I'd like to give them a free shirt.
The Dang
Bros. I think they deserve it. They get the Dang Bros. Free shirt.
No doubt. Should we have it say the Dang Bros? Or should we just have Dang Bros?
Dang Bros. Dang Bros. Just Dang Bros.
Just Dang Bros. Clean. Dang Bros.
That's it.
Dang Bros. Dal, spit an M&M line. Spit an M line. Give me an M line, Dal.
I don't know a lot of M here. Let's see. Let's see here. I was like, the only one I probably know is like...
What do you mean you don't know an M&M line? I mean, from a chorus, from a lyric?
The one
from
that always comes... I just drank a fifth of vodka, dare me to drive? Like, that always pops up in my head.
I just drank a fifth of vodka, dare me to drive?
Oh, yeah. let's see.
You know what's next after that? How about you finish it? How would I say an M line and you finish?
I could try. I'm not very good at M. Maybe do the real Slim Shady. Give me something to spit off that. I remember that one. Man, have your attention to the class, right? You can do that
so
one.
You want to just start the verse?
Yeah, whatever you think.
Yeah.
See what you got.
Y'all act like you never seen a white person before. Jaws all on the floor. Like
Pam Lee.
Pam and Tommy just burst in the door.
Started whooping her ass.
Worse than before.
First they were divorced and over the furniture. I don't know. In the return of the you're kidding.
Still,
yeah, I don't know. I'm trying
play
to
the instrumental and let Dal rap. No. Dal does not want to rap.
That's what I need. I need the music first.
Dal is not Dal. Do you really?
No, I don't.
Oh, you really? I was like,
no, let's get the hell out of here.
All right, before we
lose
everyone in there. Hi kids, do you like violence? That's obviously a classic. Oh, look at Jalal from the corner sharpshooting.
God, man, he should be shooting the ball, not shooting me some freaking music over here.
This is a copyright heavy.
Oh, man.
This is a heavy copyright clip show. That is classic.
We're in trouble.
All right, man. Let's get out of here. The Dang Bro shirt will be on Thursday. Hit up these socials at Dal Palantonio, at Jalal Suli, at OMG It's TTF, and at Most Underrated Podcast on Instagram, at MUPcast on Twitter. Thank you guys for tuning in the chat today. And thank you guys
fun
for coming
show,
through.
Man.
Thanks to everybody that came through in the super chat. Mm-hmm. We love the shit out of you fools.
Thank you, haters.
No doubt. Thank you, haters.
Love
making
it.
Us some biggest bread,
man.
Right?
Says, don't stop the camera.
Don't stop the camera. All right, fellas, we'll see you guys on Thursday.